the banks of the Tennessee River, you'll discover some of the great traditions of college football, like the Volunteer Navy dating back to 1962, and the checkerboard end zone, immaculately groomed and pristinely prepared in orange and white. The Volunteer Walk, a pilgrimage going along Volunteer Boulevard to Peyton Manning Pass and meandering onto Philip Fulmer Way. Tonight, we punctuate history one more time as Brent Schaefer makes history as the first true freshman quarterback out of high school to make his debut in an SEC opener. His time to shine. And time now for one of the great time-honored traditions in college football. The Volunteers running through the tee. The Tennessee Volunteers, rowdy, rambunctious, and ready when we come back for the opening kickoff right after this. Welcome back to Neyland Stadium under the lights for the first time on a Sunday evening as we make a little bit more history. The second meeting all time between number 15, Tennessee, and UNLV. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey. Thanks for coming aboard, Bob. Since we arrived in town a little over 24 hours ago, all we've heard is Schaefer, Ainge Schaefer, a couple of true freshmen who, hey, a little more than a month ago were worrying about what they're wearing to their high school proms.
Unbelievable, Mark. Whenever you open a season with a true freshman quarterback, it is truly a good news, bad news situation. First, the good news. It energizes your entire program. Everyone in this stadium is anxious to see if these freshmen are as good as they've been advertised. The bad news, nobody knows exactly what will happen tonight, not even Phil Fulmer. Practice is one thing, but with 100,000 people in here, Mark, this is completely different. Brent Schaefer and Eric Ainge are co-number one quarterbacks. This is going to be fun to watch, and it won't take long to find out because Tennessee is going to be on offense.
Well, interesting that each of their teammates has said that they have to give them a lot of support. For more on the quarterbacks, let's go to Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, it's been a bad news deal for UNLV as well. They have had no videotape of these two young freshman quarterbacks to help them, the defense, prepare. Now, the UNLV coaching staff said that they went to old internet websites for recruiting video. They found about 10 to 12 plays of Brent Schaefer and Eric Ainge. So instead, they went and got some old videotape of a mobile athletic Tennessee quarterback, T. Martin. To simulate Eric Ainge, they went back and looked at some Peyton Manning videotape. They said that they are not able to see the real deal, so we'll see how quickly they can adjust to seeing Brent Schaefer and Eric Ainge in person on the field.
Mark, the good news, they're not playing against T. Martin or Peyton Manning. That is the best case scenario for UNLV.
A couple of guys that had great success here in Knoxville. UNLV winning the opening toss, deferring to the second half. So Tennessee will receive the opening kickoff, and they will go on offense first. Corey Larkins is back deep along with Derek Tinsley for the Vols, wearing some throwback uniforms for tonight's ball game. There's a look at Larkins, number 23. And kicking off, it's Hubie Schulze, the German for UNLV.
And Mark, this is as electric as there is in college football, this atmosphere here in Neyland Stadium.
But a line drive kickball comes down to the 15-yard line. Good coverage by the Rebels. It's Riggs brought down at the 27-yard line. And Brent Schaefer making history, the first true freshman out of high school to make his debut in an SEC opener. He's 6'2", 195 pounds, out of Deerfield Beach, Florida. So that part of the country, as we all know by now, with a lot on their collective minds, and the young man obviously concerned about his family with Hurricane Francis recently moving through there. First down and 10 for the Vols at their own 28-yard line. Backs are set in the offset eye. Little play fake and a flag down on the far side of the field. This is what Schaefer can do. Steps out of bounds at the 36-yard line, but there's a flag back at the 26.
And Mark, right away, number 7, left-handed, can run. What's his nickname?
Little Vic. He kind of looks at the way he throws, the way he delivers the ball.
And I promise you, Phil Fulmer had one thing on his mind. Just get the quarterback center exchange on that first play of the game, but they definitely rolled him out and let him show everybody in the stadium his legs.
Schaefer threw for over 2,500 yards and 31 touchdowns as a senior. From Deerfield Beach, Florida, we have an all-SEC crew tonight for the game. And Bob, unlike yesterday, no instant replay for you and I. A big story in college football and a big picture story.
Foul is offsides, 27 of the defense. Penalty is 5 yards from the previous spot, still first down.
Penalties against Jamal Brimmer, the All-American and Thorpe candidate for UNLV. Ball's going to be spotted at the 33-yard line. It's first down and 5 to go. Cedric Houston is the deep back out of the eye. They're going to run it this time. They get about 1 yard. Time now for the Dos Equis starting lineups. Look at these skill positions for the Volunteers. Houston was the first runner to lead the team in rushing in back-to-back seasons since 96.
And Mark, Cedric Houston really gets the start despite those impressive statistics because he's a great pass protector. This is a talented offensive line, particularly Michael Munoz. You know that name. But Aaron Sears on the other side may be Philip Fulmer's favorite offensive lineman.
Michael Munoz, the son of Anthony, of course, former great for the Cincinnati Bengals and All-Pro. Second down and 5 now for Tennessee. They fake the counter, and Schaefer on the loose trying to get to the edge, and is brought down at the 37-yard line by Jamal Brimmer. And let's take a look at that Rebel defense. Dunbar-Nett getting the start instead. It's Nicholson up front. This defensive front, all three starters are gone from a season ago, so some question marks up there.
But Mark, I think the big point is it is only a three-man front, which means it's a 3-4 linebacker, 3-4 defense with four talented linebackers, and it may cause confusion for this young quarterback, Brent Schaefer, because Tennessee is a four-man front. Here you see the secondary, Jamal Brimmer, Mark, maybe as good a strong safety as there is in the country.
And Joe Miklos also very active back there, one of the leaders. Jason Swain now in the ball game for the Volunteers on first down and 10. Quick trick to drop, and he fumbles it. It's a loose ball back at the 28-yard line. Joe Miklos made the hit. We just mentioned his name, and the Rebels claiming that they have the ball. Still no official signal until now.
Mark, and if you've watched college football, you saw what BYU did to Notre Dame. You saw what New Mexico did to Washington State. Here they come with the safety blitz from the field. Jamal Brimmer, the free safety, the strong safety, coming from the field. Number 49, Ryan Claridge, the outside linebacker, jarred that ball loose.
Claridge, a second-team All-Mountain West selection from a season ago. Tennessee's worst nightmare coming through on their first possession, as the freshman put it on the ground and fumbled it. First down and 10. UNLV working with a short field at the 28-yard line. Mankis back to pass. Fires a dart. We'll be calling this guy's name a lot tonight. That is Irvin Johnson. As for Nankis, he's a 6'4 senior. A little bit unique in the sense that he's going to be 25 years old in a couple of weeks. He's a father of two and a husband, 5-year-old boy and a one-month-old daughter. So, Bob, how much sleep is that guy getting?
Another point, Mark. This guy played pro baseball. He really hasn't played all that much football, even though he's 25 years old.
Second down and 3. That's Irvin Johnson in motion to the top of your screen. Another quick drop and a completion. That's going to be a first down for UNLV. Time now for the Dos Equis backs and receivers for UNLV. Dominique Dorsey, a little guy, but very tough. Number 10 at just 5'7", 170 pounds.
And Mark, keep your eye obviously on Irvin Johnson, but Alvin Marshall, number 24, the halfback, will line up in the backfield, but they're going to displace him a lot. Here's the question mark right here, UNLV's offensive line, but John Robinson loves Marco Garrow, the left offensive tackle, says he may be the best ever to play at UNLV.
They run the other way this time, though, over the right side, as Dominic Dorsey might have gotten 2 yards. Let's take a look at the Volunteer defense. The defensive line a little thin on the insides, on the edges a little bit stronger and well off.
Talented, though, Mark, led by Perry's Harrelson, number 98. He's an athletic defensive end. These linebackers are talented. The two Kevins from California, Kevin Simon, Kevin Burnett, and Jason Mitchell. Only returning starter in the secondary, Jason Allen. Two new safeties in this game for UT. Look for UNLV to try to exploit that.
On second down and nine, Nankas back to pass over the middle. And it's knocked away at the goal line by Kevin Simon, one of those two Kevins we just mentioned. What a personable young man. We had a chance to meet him yesterday in the hotel lobby. He was really geeked up for this game.
And Mark, he really, when you look at him, looks like a defensive back in his uniform. And he is going to make a great break on this ball right here. That they tried to hit the tight end, Michael Freund, up the seam. And Kevin Simon from De La Salle High School in California, Mark. You know they got upset this weekend.
After 151 consecutive wins. Third down and nine. Pressure coming. Johnson makes the catch. And they're going to mark his forward progress just inside the 10-yard line. But it's short of the first down by about 5 yards.
And Mark, let's slow down a second and take a deep breath. Let's go back to Brent Schaefer. His first start, not as a redshirt freshman quarterback, a true freshman quarterback against that 3-4 defense of UNLV. Safety blitz, ball flies up in the air, gives UNLV a chance to go on top right here early in this football game.
Bob, this is one of the question marks for UNLV. Aguayo just got it inside the upright. He has yet to kick. That was one of the big question marks, and looks heavenward and says thank you. He knocks it through from 26 yards out. So John Robinson's team able to capitalize on the early Volunteer turnover. We'll be back under the bright lights at Neyland Stadium right after this. One of the main stories of the night, the freshman quarterback, true freshman quarterback, Brent Schaefer, along with Eric Ainge, who right now is the guy who they call 1A. They say they have two co-starters, so both expected to play tonight. Question becomes, Bob, how soon does Eric Ainge come in?
Yeah, Mark, and that's the tough coaching situation that Philip Fulmer is in. They're kind of different guys, opposites. One's from the East Coast, one's from the West Coast, one's more of a passer, one's more of a runner. Philip Fulmer will have a lot of decisions to make as this game progresses.
Jose Zumclay knocks it 5 yards deep into the end zone, where Corey Larkins will take the knee and come out to the 20-yard line. Let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, you might be wondering how the young quarterback would react after his fumble on his first series. Brent Schaefer came to the sideline. He didn't hang his head. He didn't apologize. He went to Cedric Houston and talked about some protection problems. He got the coaches over. Looked like there was some miscommunication on his protection. So really great demeanor from him on the sideline, guys. Not a lot of hangdog expression. Just let's fix it and let's get back out there.
Yeah, good point, Holly. And it's listeners saying that Schaefer actually came to campus very early at the end of June, was able to put in a lot of time in the program before getting pads on and getting onto the field, and feels very comfortable, he says. Meacham now and Brown, the receivers for the Volunteers. First down and 10 from their own 20-yard line. This is their second offensive possession. Nicholson makes the stop on the play on Cedric Houston.
The ideal situation for Tennessee is obviously, let's line up and run that football. Let's take the pressure off the young quarterback, but it's not that easy. This 3-4 defense, particularly with a team that safety blitzes, is going to challenge Tennessee and almost make them throw the football, Mark.
UNLV guys flying around so far on defense, already causing a turnover. And now we see Schaefer audibling at the line. Meacham, Swain, and Brown, the receivers. It jets him into a good play. Nice shake and a first down out of the 38-yard line for Cedric Houston. The second team All-SEC selection with a good block up front by Michael Munoz. Nice burst off that left side.
And you see right away Brent Schaefer up at the line, checking at the line of scrimmage, Mark. A lot of composure for a young guy. You're going to see an excellent block by Michael Munoz. The defensive end, Leon Moore, goes inside. But I'm surprised but yet impressed that Tennessee's able to do this right here. And you see him looking over at the sidelines, getting the check from the coaches.
Randy Sanders, one of those coaches, the offensive coordinator. They hand it off again to the deep back. Nice run over the left side again. Cedric Houston Interesting that late last season he was slowed by injury, but he led the team in rushing in 03 and in 02.
And I'm going to tell you, Mark, excuse me, I know what's motivating Cedric Houston right now. It's been talked about. It's been written about. The only reason he's starting is because of pass protection and familiarity with the scheme. They really want to get Gerald Riggs in here to run the football. He's taking that as a personal challenge. I mean, he ripped that one up in there.
Here he is again, this time running between the tackles. And Bob, you bring up a good point after he gains about 2 yards. Claridge making the stop. With two true freshman quarterbacks, you want to keep them off their backsides and upright. Pass protection becomes paramount.
No question. If you've noticed early in this game, Tennessee in a lot of two-back sets with two backs in the backfield for protection purposes, also playing with a tight end at times. So they're trying to keep that young freshman quarterback from having too much off the corner. Once again, you see here, a tight end, two backs in the game, Mark.
And there's Gerald Riggs watching patiently from the sidelines, waiting to spell Houston. Third down and two. The first down. Houston still on his feet. Houston plowing forward down to the 42-yard line and into Rebel territory. A missed tackle by Joe Miklos that time, the free safety.
Mark, I'll tell you what, Cedric Houston has taken this thing personal about, well, I'm a great pass protector. That's a great move right there. He flat ran over Ernest Gordon, number 14 from UNLV.
Cedric Houston, Gerald Riggs Jr., Corey Larkins, a deep set of backs for Tennessee. He has 36 yards, Houston does, on this drive. The pass complete. Down to the 33-yard line. That's Derek Tinsley, a 6-foot senior. So the true freshman quarterback with a little bit of poise that time in the pocket. And got
Mark,
it there.
And Mark, they talk about when Brent Schaefer came on campus. He came the day after he graduated from high school. It was like a caravan coming up on Interstate 95 out of Florida. Grandparents, parents, they said the first day he went out there in 7-on-7 with his teammates, they said, wow, this guy can throw it. They knew he could run it, but the first time he let it fly in the summer, they said, we got us a quarterback.
Marching them down the field here, down to the UNLV 33. Another nice run. A first down at the 22-yard line. Stopped by John Andrews. That time it was Gerald Riggs getting his opportunity. And he's ready to light up Neyland Knight. The son of Gerald Riggs, former NFLer.
Mark, Tennessee brought 450 former players back here. They're wearing retro uniforms. Old school football, man. Line up with that fullback in the backfield, run ISOs, and that fullback is 270 pounds. Corey Anderson, who was a defensive end. So retro uniforms, old school football, Mark.
Willie Gault watching this game, honored before the game, would have been proud of that one. Run it again. Terrence Young making the stop that time on Houston. Actually, Riggs once again. Interesting that injuries really slowed Gerald Riggs Jr. for the first two seasons here.
Something you see, Mark, is Tennessee bringing the wide receiver in, Tony Brown, to be a blocker. See him right there outside the offensive tackle, really trying to protect that strong safety blitz coming from the field. So great wide receivers in this game also have to be great blockers. Here comes the strong safety from the field. Bluffing him. Brent Schaefer steps out. Look at him looking over to the sidelines, getting the checks.
They've had 10 running plays and one passing play on this drive. Second and 8. Quick three-step drop. Missed his man at the 14-yard line. Let's go back to the studio.
All right, Mark. You know, Mark May is the Fresno State is the ultimate BCS buster. Fresno taking off Washington, and Paul Penninger finding Joe Fernandez for the touchdown up in Seattle, and Pat Hill's team's up by 4. Fourth quarter just starting.
All right, Reese back here. It's third down, 8 to go. Ball in the 19, Bob.
And Mark, I'm a little bit surprised that Tennessee is doing so much checking with this young quarterback. I thought they would line up and snap it a little bit more. Look for quarterback draw, jailbreak screen.
Quarterback draw. There it is. And a first down at the 5.5-yard line. Brent Schaefer. What a valuable added dimension he brings to the table.
Mark, Tennessee talked about spreading the field, going man-to-man pass protection to try to create lanes for Brent Schaefer. That time, it was the predetermined quarterback draw. I think an excellent call. Surprised that UNLV didn't realize that that was coming. That one was pretty obvious.
Ran for almost 600 yards and 15 touchdowns last year in his senior year in high school. First down and goal for the Volunteers.
Again, you see the wide receiver in to protect the corner.
Riggs still on his feet. And gang tackle swarmed at about the 2.5. Number 49, Ryan Claridge, one of the leaders on that 3-4 defensive front for UNLV.
And the decision just got a little bit easier for Philip Fulmer. Keep that young freshman in there, keeping it going. Don't make me make a real tough decision right now early in this football game.
He's bounced back pretty well after that fumble on the last drive. His team looking at second down and goal right now. An impressive drive that started on their own 20-yard line.
Mark, and keep an eye on this big fullback, 270 pounds, Corey Anderson, as a lead blocker right here.
Short of the end zone. Talked about the bevy of running backs that they have. That one was Jabari Davis. Davis is the short yardage specialist.
He comes in with 20 career touchdowns. Once again, the safety. That time, Joe Miklos up there at the line of scrimmage. There you see the new running back coach at Tennessee, Trooper Taylor, who came here from Baylor. Came here from Tulane, has done an excellent job with these talented running backs of Tennessee.
13th play of the drive. Third down and goal. Jabari Davis, the deep back out of the eye. Davis went up. No, he kept it. Schaefer kept it. Oh, he looked like Houdini. What a fake. Touchdown.
And Mark, they're already selling number 7 jerseys in the Tennessee bookstore. They're hot off the press right now.
Brent Schaefer, with a little bit of sleight of hand. Maybe it's not so sleight of hand. He really sold that fake. As did Jabari Davis. And the Tennessee Volunteers march it down the field 80 yards. James Wilhoit. He wears the same number. He's got the same kind of role and the same kind of stroll. Yeah, they call him Little Vic. He shook up UNLV on that one, and they had the lead 7-3 when we come back. Welcome back, everyone. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern, ESPN celebrating 25 spectacular years with our Silver Anniversary Special. We'll look at the defining moments from our early coverage of the NCAA tournament to the World Series earthquake, 1987's America's Cup, This Is SportsCenter's ad campaign, the acquisition of the NFL, and more. ESPN 25 Silver Anniversary Special on ESPN. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Well, Brent Schaefer certainly deserves a rest and certainly deserves kudos after bouncing back during that last drive.
And I'll tell you what, UNLV better go in and retape those ankles because he may break a couple of those ankles on those defenders before the night's over. He is a sudden guy.
Ball comes down to Dorsey. Dominic Dorsey in the clear. One man to beat. Dominic Dorsey trying to answer. Picks up a bevy of blockers and a nice return for the Rebels down to the 34-yard line. And that puts a silencer on these Volunteer fans.
I'll tell you what, Mark, here's another John Robinson quote. Quick as anyone I have ever coached is Dominic Dorsey, and they did a great job blocking. That actually should have been a tripping call right there on Tennessee. And you see the quickness of this little running back. Mark, this guy gained over 7,000 yards in high school in California, the most ever.
Bob, a great return of 59 yards. deep into Tennessee territory for the second consecutive time. They begin with good field position. Last time they got a field goal. Nantes under pressure. Oh, he threw it up for grabs, and it's caught down at the 10-yard line by Irvin Johnson, but there's a flag down at the 18. Hold on a minute.
Mark, I would think that would be holding on Tennessee.
Now you did that without instant replay today. Back here at Neyland Stadium, a panoramic view of some 106,000 plus. The first time ever under the night lights on a Sunday evening. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe. Number 15 Tennessee leading 7-3 over UNLV in a game so far that has seen a talented true freshman quarterback come back after an early stumble. But now UNLV threatening on the 10-yard line. They're going to say the 9 and first and goal. And we got another flag on the play. Let's take one more look at that great run by Brent Schaefer for the touchdown.
Mark, I talked about UNLV retaping those ankles. Right there you see Ryan Claridge miss. Watch right here. Oh, 52. The outside linebacker, John Andrews, right there. That's some athleticism by that young quarterback.
Foul is illegal movement by the offensive number 67. Penalty 5 yards from the previous spot for the first down.
Mark, in 25 years of coaching, coached in a bunch of different stadiums, this atmosphere, when we played down here in 1999, under the lights in Neyland Stadium, maybe the most intimidating I've ever been experienced with. Don't look for UNLV to check a lot right here.
Marshall and Dorsey, the backs, they run it into the boundary that time. That was Dominic Dorsey who had the great kickoff return a few moments ago, brought down by Jason Allen.
And Mark, these are great fans at Tennessee. 107,000 people in here on a Sunday night. UNLV, they're on their own. They had 5,000 tickets allocated to them. They returned 4,300. So if my math's right, there's 700 UNLV people in this stadium.
Oh, boy. Don't plan on hearing them too much tonight. Single back set, Nantes firing almost interception at the 7-yard line. It was intended for Irvin Johnson, but it was batted away by Rashawn Fellows. It'll be third down and goal for UNLV.
We talked about Tennessee, Mark, a young defensive football team. They lost two safeties to the NFL. Look at the confusion right here by Tennessee. Tennessee dodged a bullet right there. So Tennessee, a very young defensive football team, only two seniors on their top 31.
Yeah, last year the secondary was actually the strength of that Tennessee defense.
And this crowd is a factor right now.
Third and goal. Nantes has a man. The pass complete at the 4-yard line. That's Donnell Wheaton, but there's a flag down back at the 14.
And by looking at Nantes' helmet, it may be a late hit right here on Tennessee on the quarterback.
We have an SEC officiating crew tonight.
No, Mark, it looks like it's going to be holding, yeah.
Talking to Kevin Burnett, one of the team captains on defense there, along with Kevin Simon, the two linebackers. Tennessee last year finishing up 10-3. How many places do you hear people say, we need a bounce back year after a 10-3 season?
Mark, everybody remembers the last one. And if you think back, they got beat pretty good in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl.
The offense is number 70. Penalty is 10 yards from the previous spot with a repeat of the third down.
The penalty is against number 70, Marco Guerra. 6'5", 350-pound sophomore. There's John Robinson in his sixth season, former head coach at USC, the Los Angeles Rams, and has his son David as an assistant coach with him at UNLV. They finished 6-6 last year after a great 4-1 start and stumbled a little bit. Third down and goal back at the 20-yard line. Looking at Johnson. He turned the other way, and it's incomplete. Fourth down and goal. Coverage on the play by Brandon Johnson. And once again comes Sergio Aguayo.
Mark, John Robinson had a great line before the game. I asked him about the crowd noise, how he was handling that scenario. He said he was hoping that Tennessee fans would be bored with UNLV coming in here and not Florida. These fans aren't bored.
There's Aguayo. Misses this one to the right. Missed it from 37 yards out after making one from 26. Seven to three, and on our next series, we are told that Eric Ainge will be coming in to lead that Tennessee offense. Stick around, we'll be back. Back, everyone, under the lights at Neyland Stadium. The score is 7-3 for the home team with 3:08 to go now in the first quarter of play. And in at quarterback for Tennessee to direct the offense is Eric Ainge. He's a 6'6", 200-pound freshman from Hillsboro, Oregon. The nephew of Danny Ainge, former BYU star and Boston Celtics star. Hands it off on his first play, and a nice play to Corey Larkins, who plows his way forward, stopped up by Nicholson. Ainge is a senior, threw for over 3,000 yards and 24 touchdowns. And, Bob, contrasting style from the guy we just saw in Schaefer.
No question, Mark. Obviously, you see right there, 6'6", 200 pounds. He's from the West Coast, from Oregon. But really, as a coach right now, you're handling the psyche of these young guys as much as the mechanics. And what Ainge has to be careful, it's human nature that he's in competition with Schaefer for the starting job. Don't try to do too much. Play and do what is best for the team. Don't be selfish, even though that's hard not to be.
He's shown a lot of moxie in the pocket, albeit in training camp. Houston breaks a couple of tackles. Houston in on space. They can't get a grip on Cedric Houston. As a result, a first down out near midfield. A gain of 23 yards on the play. And, boy, Cedric Houston getting his swerve on tonight.
Leading rusher the last 2 years, Mark. And what I am impressed about how hard these Tennessee running backs run. You see again right there, another missed tackle by UNLV, Rashard Dodd Masters. This is a physical group of running backs.
And Houston and Riggs tonight do a nice job. And Jabari Davis, when he came in short yardage. Larkins now the deep back out of the eye. Claycock running down. It's at three. A little miscommunication. Reese, what's going on with the Huskies?
Not much, but a lot going on with the Bulldogs. Fresno State is opening up a can, Mark. This is Dwayne Wright. This is the third touchdown, either coming after a turnover or scored directly by the defense. Two of them scored by the D. Pat Hill's team hammering Washington 28-10.
All right, Reason back here, second and 10. Looks like the receiver and Ainge were not on the same page that time.
Well, Mark, ironically, Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator, told me yesterday that Eric Ainge very rarely ever throws a bad pass. But there's 107,000 people in this place tonight. That's a lot different than that.
Receiver screen complete that time to C.J. Faton. Talked about Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator. Bob, he was telling us earlier in our meetings that one of the most difficult things to teach a young quarterback is what they like to use at Tennessee, the three wide receiver, two running back set, and some of the nuances of that offense.
Exactly, Mark, because as a defense, you're able to disguise things a lot against the three wide receiver, two back set. That's why you see them when they're in that three wide receiver set, the young quarterbacks will look over at the sidelines to get the check.
Third down.
To look for UNLV to cat and mouse them and really start to disguise things.
Third down and one. Eric Ainge at quarterback for the first time. Looking up top, has a man open. Faton. Touchdown, Tennessee.
Well, start getting the number 10 jerseys ready in the bookstore now, too, Mark.
Right beside the number sevens as Faton took it in for six. A 42-yard touchdown reception off the great pass from Eric Ainge. Got in behind Dodd Masters, and Faton had easy sail into the end zone. Will Hoyt knocks through the extra point, and Tennessee has John Robinson's team down 14-3. And Philip Fulmer, boy, what a great set of quarterbacks he has so far.
Again, Eric Ainge gets that check from the sidelines. That's kind of as easy as it was out in Oregon, Mark. There wasn't a whole lot of coverage. That looked like a high school coverage, but you're going to see Fainton right here. And surprisingly, Rashad Dyke-Masters, UNLV, one of their most experienced corners, comes up and really just guessed on that. And that's an easy one right there for Eric Ainge.
Eric Ainge has tremendous lineage when it comes to his athletic talents. His father, Doug, played basketball at BYU. And actually, Eric Ainge, you look at his numbers, 80 yards passing, put 7 points on the board. Schaefer also has put 7 on the board. But back to Ainge for a second. His father, Doug, played basketball at BYU. His grandfather was a three-sport star at the University of Oregon, and spoke with Danny Ainge earlier in the week about his nephew, and he said that the two of them talked over the course of the last year, Bob, because there was at one point a thought that Eric might play basketball as a junior in Oregon. He made All-State and his All-Regional team, averaged over 16 points a game as a shooting guard. But he felt that he could be a good basketball player, but maybe a little bit more special football quarterback.
I think that's a great story, Mark, and you're very fortunate to have the kind of experience, obviously, he has in that family. Traveling across the country, leaving home, coming from Oregon to Tennessee was not a drastic jump like it would be for a lot of young men. So he has the advantage of having a very experienced family that's dealt with these issues.
Dorsey ran the last one back 59 yards, but not this time. He takes the knee 4 yards deep. Well, Thursday night at 9 Eastern, ABC's Monday Night Football officially opens its season when the Super Bowl champs, New England Patriots, host the Indianapolis Colts. Say, that's a rematch of the AFC Championship game. Thursday night at 8 Eastern time, 6 Pacific, it's the Colts and the Patriots. It's the kickoff to Monday Night Football's 35th year, and it all starts this Thursday. ABC Sports Championship Television. Get a look at the former Vols quarterback Peyton Manning in that game. Got some good offensive weapons with Marvin Harrison, Edgerrin James. First down and 10 from the 20-yard line. This is UNLV's worst starting field position. Burlow in motion. Handoff is to Dorsey, and Dorsey with a nice gain and a first down at the 32-yard line. Dominic Dorsey, all 5'7", 170 of them. At one point, the most prolific runner in high school football in California. Really emerged last year when Larry Kroom was injured. Kroom, by the way, presently with the Phoenix Cardinals in the NFL.
Mark, was, as a young guy, he was a Mountain West Conference freshman of the year, really as a return man. Last year had back-to-back 100-yard games.
And just hands it off. And he's showing that he can get it done in tight and close quarters, too. Another nice run by the diminutive Dominic Dorsey.
Mark, a point to make. You notice the contrast. You see the size difference there of Dominic Dorsey compared to those linemen, but Tennessee has those big, strong power backs. So every day in practice, Tennessee is practicing against those 225, 230-pound tailbacks. They don't have a guy that's 5'7", 155 pounds to practice against with this kind of quickness.
Good point, and now Perkins comes in, spelling Dominic Dorsey. He gets strung out and brought down at the 40-yard line as time winds down in the first quarter of play. That'll do it for the first quarter. Tennessee, number 15 in the country, looking to bounce back and make a big splash tonight in their season debut, being led by a couple of youngsters. Brett Schaefer with a couple of shakes for their first touchdown, and Eric Ainge with a deft touch for their second one. Back after this. Back on the banks of the Tennessee River as the Tennessee Volunteers, number 15 in the country, lead UNLV by a score of 14-3. The Rebels with the ball. It'll be third down and 2 at their own 40-yard line. UNLV got on the scoreboard first. If you're just joining us, they led 3-0, capitalizing on an early Tennessee fumble. But since that point, the balls have answered with 14 straight points. Ankes has his pass batted down at the line of scrimmage. It'll be fourth down and 2. Good pressure up front that time by Justin Harrell and Carlton Neal. The fourth down and into punt will be Gary Cook.
Mark, I've got a little stat for you. We've heard this band from Tennessee play Rocky Top a bunch of times already, haven't we?
You think?
They play it on an average of 42 times a game.
Where'd you get that, man?
I pulled a little nugget out. I've coached here before. I promise you, later in the week, you'll be humming Rocky Top. One of the worst experiences to get beat as a head coach in this stadium is be humming Rocky Top later in the week.
Might not take that long for me to hum it. Swain lets it bounce. And it takes a fortuitous bounce in favor of UNLV all the way down to the 6-yard line. Well, we've heard the players talk about their true freshman quarterback. Let's hear what head coach Bill Footler had to say about his QBs.
Schaefer, the first thing everybody's going to see probably is his ability to scramble and run. He is an excellent passer. And then the first thing they're going to see on Eric Ainge is his ability to throw the football, but he's a pretty good scrambler too. Both of them have, I don't know, whatever it is, you know, they have it.
Well, one of them who has it is back in the game. That one is Eric Ainge, back in for his second offensive series. Let's look at the comparison of what they've done so far. Both of them have been very productive. Handoff is to Houston. Got hit near the line of scrimmage, falling forward for about 2 yards. Cedric Houston has been very productive so far in the ballgame for Tennessee, running the ball 8 times for a total of 62 yards.
UNLV, Mark, you're right. They run hard. You're looking at Ryan Claridge right here, number 49, 6'4", 250. John Robinson thinks he is an NFL linebacker, All-State in football and tennis. That's a big man on that court, man.
It's a strange, diverse combination on 2nd down and 8. Bouncing it outside, or trying to, thinking of, was Houston. Stopped out that time by Isaac Watts. It'll be 3rd down and about 7 to go.
And we said, as we look at Cedric Houston's numbers right here, Mark, the best case scenario for Tennessee, run the football, take the pressure off the quarterbacks, and that's exactly what they have done in this football game.
In Houston, Riggs, Larkins, Jabari Davis, the running back coach, we saw him earlier, Trooper Taylor, has done a nice job fostering a very family-friendly atmosphere.
And you see Tennessee again in the 3-wide set. This causes fans a bunch of angst, Mark, because they see that 25-second clock running down.
And it's worth the while, though. It was worth the wait. Cedric Houston has the first down at the 37-yard line. Cedric Houston running with determination. A 28-yard gain, and they move the chains again. Nice surge off that right side, running over Douglas and Sears.
Mark, again, Tennessee in the 3-wide receiver set. Simply what they're doing is seeing if the linebacker displaces or the linebacker's in the box. They determine whether it's run or pass.
Yeah, you can really see the cat and mouse game going on between the offensive coordinator, defensive coordinator, and the quarterback, Eric Ainge. Got rid of it quickly. Perhaps looking for the out and up. Let's go back to that previous big run, the nice gain by Cedric Houston. See how they got into that play, Bob.
Mark, it's pretty simple. It's how many people are in the box, determined by how many safeties are deep and how far those linebackers are extended. Here on 3rd down, UNLV had 2 deep safeties. Tennessee outnumbers them in the running game. On this last play that we saw, UNLV had 1 safety in the middle, man-to-man coverage on the outside. They checked. But look for UNLV's coaches to figure out what's happening here and start to really disguise things.
It's Houston again out to the 40-yard line. Not quite the dog days of the college football season, but Holly has more anyway.
Hey, guys, we have the 2 young quarterbacks for Tennessee, but we've got a new young pup here. Smokey, number 9, is making his debut tonight. He is the first time coming out here in this big stadium. Now, his handlers are from the fraternity Alpha Gamma Rho. They said they have taken him to many different functions, alumni gatherings, Letterman Club gatherings, to get him used to the noise, people petting him and everything. He is a blue tick coonhound, and when he's not with his private owners, he is here at the fraternity house. How'd you like that for a new young pup, guys? Mark?
And Mark, you know what I heard? Smokey ate bit someone.
No.
Yeah.
No.
And the worst part, the guy was wearing orange. The guy
really?
Was wearing orange. If it would have been another color.
Wasn't an Alabama fan?
I don't know.
Smokey, what's up with that? Back with more after this. Back in the second quarter, 12-13 to go in the first half. And Corey Larkin, the deep back. Tennessee with the ball, third down and seven. Eric Ainge, the true freshman in at quarterback.
And the chess game continues, Mark.
This has been the constant pattern for both quarterbacks for Tennessee since the game began.
And you notice how educated these fans are. It's as quiet as it can be. Tennessee's back there checking.
Ainge going up top. Incomplete at the 20-yard line. He tried to find Jason Swain. Swain, one of those speed burners for Tennessee. Played in all 13 games a season ago. All freshmen in the SEC a year ago.
We're going to get it isolated down here at the bottom. Jason Swain, the ball goes up on top on Rashard Dodd Masters. I thought it was an excellent no call there, Mark. Do you agree?
Yeah. Yep. Good defense by the corner. And as a result, Dustin Colquitt coming in to punt.
And this guy punts it out of the stadium now.
Following in a long line of punters with that surname, Colquitt. Son of Craig Colquitt, cousin of Jimmy, his brother Britton also on the squad, and gets off a moonshot down to the 9-yard line. Great coverage, too, by the special teams. A 50-yard punt and 4 yards on the return by Donnell Wheaton. Wow. We'll be back with more right after this. On campus tonight in Knoxville, Tennessee, on the banks of the Tennessee River. UNLV with some work to do. They trail 14-3 with 11:52 to go in the first half. Perkins and Dorsey, the backs behind Nankis. As Dominique Dorsey getting to the edge. Has a first down and is out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Boy, he's got a good burst to him, doesn't he?
He does, Mark, in an excellent misdirection play and an excellent block by Deontay Perkins, number 5, right here on the linebacker. A little bit of holding right there, not called on number 2, Kevin Burnett. But, man, Dominic Dorsey is an explosive little running back.
A pickup of 26 yards gives UNLV a first down and 10.
Mark, you see, UNLV does not lack explosive talent at the skill positions with Irvin Johnson at wide receiver and Dominic Dorsey in the backfield.
Run a little reverse here. This is Terry Furlow. And Furlow is tackled at the 42-yard line by Kevin Burnett, saying his name a lot so far this evening. We're here at Neyland Stadium. The first ever Sunday night game here, as we do have a flag on the play. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe. Number 15, Tennessee, leading UNLV by a score of 14-3. And the story of the game coming in, the two true freshman quarterbacks for Tennessee. Co-number ones, the decision made a couple of weeks ago by head coach Philip Fulmer that he would go that route, which really caught a lot of people by surprise.
Henley is unsportsmanlike, number 2 on the defense. Henley is 15 yards from the end of the run, followed by a first down.
They called it on Burnett.
Well, Mark, it's pretty easy now that they're calling out those penalties and giving the numbers over the PA system. And Kevin Burnett, that will get called, Mark. I know you rolled your eyes a little bit.
What is that about,
that.
Really?
Well, it's about really...
I still don't understand the intent of that.
Well, I think the intent is to bring attention upon yourself and not your football team or your teammates.
The pass is complete. That was Donnell Wheaton with the catch, and he is near another first down at the 34-yard line.
And, Mark, I agree that sometimes that thing gets called really close and it can be controversial, but I think as a cardinal rule, those officials will let you go as long as you're not trying to embarrass an opponent or you're just bringing attention upon yourself with some kind of hand signal.
It's so subjective, though. It's tough to really tell sometimes.
There's no question, but these SEC officials, just like at every other conference, it's clearly defined what you can do in celebration and what you can't do in celebration, Mark.
First down and 10. Nankin is going upstairs, and it's picked off at the 12. Right into the teeth of the secondary, Corey Campbell, an all-SEC pick last year, had a room service interception, and there's another flag down on the field.
Right.
And we might have another personal foul slash celebration type penalty.
The interception, miscommunication. Number four, Irvin Johnson at the bottom of the field stops. Kurt Mankus throws the ball right to the safety, and you are going to see the safety, number 26, Corey Campbell, right in the middle of the field. Let's see if we can see this excessive celebration penalty. Maybe we can come back to that.
First down and 10 coming back the other way. And it's Schaefer back in at quarterback off the play fake. Completes the pass to the fullback, Corey Anderson, out to the 18-yard line. Let's see if we can find where exactly that penalty occurred. If that's what it was for, I'll be really shocked.
I don't think that was it.
You know, Bob, at some point, there's a whole generation of people out there.
Oh, now, wait a second.
There's a whole generation of people. They're
going to
say that some people do need fiber in their diets because you cannot legislate emotion out of a game like football, especially football.
No, Mark, your point is well taken.
Second down and two. Schaefer back in at quarterback. And he runs it. That's Corey Larkins. I understand the intent of it. I think it's a great idea that it not be an individual type of thing where people bring attention to themselves, but some things are so spontaneous, Bob. You know, you're a coach. Things are emotional. You may throw yourself up in the air, roll on the ground just out of sheer joy. I don't think in the spirit of things you should be penalized for something,
Mark,
like that.
And I agree. If it's spontaneous, if you jump up off that field, you celebrate with your teammates, I agree 100%. But when you start giving hand signals and doing certain gestures, that has to be predetermined in my mind. You don't see very seldom guys playing out in the backyard jump up off the ground and give hand signals and do different things. It may be construed as an embarrassing opponent. So you and I, are we on the same page?
You got it.
We're together. We're okay on this. Now, Philip Fulmer is not on the same page with that right now.
I
promise you.
Yeah, bottom line is his rules are the only rules that count when it comes to Tennessee.
All that matters is the referee and the official's rule that all that matters. And that yellow hanky says it all.
First down and 10, the ball at the 18-and-a-half-yard line. Corey Larkins is the lone back out of the offset eye. Schaefer off the fake. They like getting him to the edge, and this is exactly why. Brent Schaefer down to the 38-yard line, another Tennessee first down. How do you defend that?
Well, first of all, Mark, if you're UNLV's coaches, you say, we had it defended, but Jamal Brimmer, the strong safety you're going to see right here, rushes inside and loses contain. You cannot lose contain against a Brent Schaefer style of athlete. So they had the great defense on it. The strong safety blitz from the field, just poor execution by UNLV. But you're right. I mean, this guy's got a little magic. And getting back to what Phil Fulmer said, he has that it factor.
Sure does. Corey Larkins, the lone back after that gain of 19 by Schaefer. Run down to the 41-yard line. Risa, what about you and the celebration thing, man? Show me a sign or something.
Spontaneous. You know, if you make a big play, sort of like the one that Fresno State's Richard Marshall's going to make right there, a little pick six, I think you can do a little dance, enjoy yourself. That is the third defensive touchdown that the Bulldogs have scored on the day. Did you see the little high step, Mark? I'm okay with that. No flags. Play on. Bulldogs rolling.
I'm feeling you, Reese.
Yeah,
I'm feeling you with that high step.
How well Reese weaved that in. I want to see Trev Alberts and Mark May square off in this issue at halftime.
As long as guys aren't doing a little choreographed dance number, I got no problem. Second down and seven. And Schaefer wants to talk a little bit longer about this issue at hand. So far, both Schaefer and Ainge having a pretty good night directing the Tennessee offense.
And really, Mark, things going according to script right now for Randy Sanders, and that really helps these young quarterbacks. Their execution has really been pretty good.
second quarter with 8:06 to go. Tennessee with the ball. 14-3 leaders right now. UNLV looking for a little bit of payback, dating back to 1996 when they came here and got dusted 62-3. It's the second meeting all time between these two crews, and a blitz coming by the Rebel defense. Schaefer picked it up, and did he ever. A first down pass to Chris Hannon, complete at the 46-yard line. This is a young man, Schaefer, with a lot on his mind right now, playing, no doubt, with a heavy heart. We've all heard about the ravaging effects of Hurricane Francis right now. He's from Deerfield Beach, and right now the irony, Bob, is that his stepfather and grandmother are at home in Deerfield Beach. He spoke with them earlier. They are not able to watch the game because they have no power.
Mark, amazing, isn't it? When you put this into proper perspective, a true freshman quarterback, 107,000 people in this stadium, his family's back there dealing with Hurricane Francis. Really is remarkable what these young guys can do.
First down and 10. Schaefer. Pass was batted down nicely by Jamal Brimmer, the All-American candidate. Schaefer and Ainge today have both made their marks offensively. Schaefer has run for a touchdown. Ainge has passed for one. Watch this move. Tough to think of the last time they had a quarterback that could run those type of plays in the offense. And Ainge, meanwhile, dropped it in there when he checked to that play. Eric Ainge with great bloodlines. Second down and 10.
And Mark, it's obvious that the only set that Tennessee is really checking at the line of scrimmage out of is this three wide receiver, two back set. All other formations, they're lining up and snapping the football.
Well, great running by the Tennessee backs. Corey Larkins broke three tackles. A pickup of 15 yards and a first down for the Volunteers.
And Mark, let me go back to the point I made about who you practice against in preseason practice is so important, because there is no exhibition games like in the NFL. UNLV's defense practices against an undersized running back in Dominic Dorsey. Now all of a sudden, you've got these big, strong power backs, and it's hard to tackle. Tackling's the key thing in this football game right now, or lack of tackling by UNLV.
Yeah, you're right. First down and 10. It off once again. It's brought down to the 30s. Corey Larkins. Interesting thing about Corey Larkins and Trooper Taylor, the running backs coach, talked about how he has really gotten a family atmosphere amongst all the backs with Houston, Riggs, Larkins, and Jabari Davis. And Larkins is really the prankster of the bunch. And here's a look at the quarterback comparisons. Schaefer with 136 total yards, and Ainge not too bad at 114.
Mark, getting back to your point about Tennessee's running backs, with the new coach, Trooper Taylor, we talked about the new quarterbacks, young quarterbacks, different quarterbacks energizing the program. So does a new position coach. And these Tennessee running backs looked energized to me. They look like they're playing hard right now.
Schaefer, buying a little time, and a flag down on the play. Jamal Brimmer in the neighborhood might have delivered a late blow to the quarterback.
Fellas, a dead ball, personal foul, late hit, number 27 for the defense. Penalty is 15 yards from the end of the run, followed by an automatic first down.
And Mark, Jamal Brimmer, defensive player of the year, two straight years in the Mountain West Conference. Let's call it what it is. He's making some young guy mistakes tonight, in my opinion. Losing contain, missing some tackles. And then, even though that wasn't a flagrant late foul, in this situation, in this scenario, I think that was a dumb mistake.
No doubt. And with 6:03 to go, UNLV calling a timeout. And don't forget that tomorrow night at 8 Eastern, ESPN celebrating 25 spectacular years of our silver anniversary special. We'll look at the defining moments from our early coverage of the NCAA tournament, the World Series earthquake, and the 87 America's Cup. There's a SportsCenter ad campaign, that one too, the acquisition of the NFL, and more. ESPN 25 silver anniversary special on ESPN tomorrow night at 8 Eastern. Bob, I remember that 87 America's Cup, and Dennis Conner skipping that boat. Bet you didn't know, as a yachting guy.
Well, and you bring up a good point. 87, I was coaching. I didn't realize there were other things that went on outside that office and the film room and the practice field. So
College Station
at the time? Up to speed. Yeah. 87, yeah, that would have been our third year in College Station. So I'm kind of getting back to the real world. And one thing,
years.
You know, people always ask me what's different about coaching and doing football analyst stuff. We were going to the stadium yesterday. You have to remember this drive to the stadium.
Yeah.
We might have been a little bit late, and all of a sudden, Holly Rowe, we had to stop and get hairspray. That's different. That's a lot different than stopping
her.
That bus.
Yeah. Never would have done that as a head coach, right?
Well, I haven't seen the bus stop on the way to the game to stop and get hairspray, but I know Holly could do
hair like that right there on the screen, right? That's what it looked like before the spray, right, Holly?
Bob,
go ahead,
I have
Holly.
To say, though, you didn't complain. You were right there with me. I called an audible. You went with me. You made the check in the car, and we made it work.
Well, Holly, I was outnumbered because Mark had to have his Red Bull. So it was two against one. I mean, it was a losing situation for me.
It's all about the sudden change offense. First down and 10 right now for Tennessee. 6:03 to go in the first half. Schaefer into the end zone. Flag down. This is going to be interference against Rashad Dodd-Masters on Robert Meacham. John Robinson protesting. It appeared as if there was a lot of contact between Dodd-Masters. Seemed like he had both hands on the receiver Meacham while the ball was in the air.
Pass interference by the defense. Number 3 in the end zone. Ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
Well, Doyle Jackson, our referee, the white cap, a real busy guy today. They'll be first down and goal.
And Mark, just to show you what's going on, the chess match right here, you see one safety in the middle of that field. Deep.
Right.
Tennessee checks to the pass. Now we're going to see the pass interference. No question right there. Dodd-Masters penalty. And some of these defensive players that UNLV was really counting on, the experienced defensive players in this game right now, Mark, are struggling.
This is the 10th play of the drive for Tennessee. Riggs. Touchdown, Volunteers. His second career rushing touchdown.
Mark, this is a strong, physical football team, and I am really impressed with these running backs.
Gerald Riggs Jr., one of them, one of four talented backs for Tennessee. They get the snap down, and Will Hoyt knocks it through. Gerald Riggs Jr., the son of Gerald Riggs Sr., former great running back and all-pro in the NFL with the Redskins and the Falcons. Papa would have been proud of that one. More when we come back. It's all about the push-up sometimes after the scoring play. In the last scoring drive, 10 plays, 83 yards. Gerald Riggs Jr. with a 2-yard touchdown run to cap things off. And Brent Schaefer led that touchdown drive. So he's led two scoring drives. Eric Ainge has led the other one. Dorsey won't get an opportunity to return this one. He'll come out to the 20-yard line. Well, on Tuesday, September the 7th, wear your favorite team's apparel to work. In exchange, each participant can make a donation of $5 or more to the V Foundation to benefit cancer research. Anyone can participate. For more details, log on to www.jimmyv.org. And I know that on Tuesday, I'm going to wear my favorite York University t-shirt to work. Jimmy V, a late good friend of mine. Lots of spirit here in Neyland Stadium. They came here with high expectations. Trying to expunge the sour and bitter taste of a defeat in the Peach Bowl, the last game of the year last season for Tennessee. UNLV first and 10. Dorsey, little guy breaking a couple tackles, got about 7 on first down.
The offensive coordinator for UNLV, Mark, is Bruce Snyder, longtime head coach at Utah State, Cal, Arizona State, coached for John Robinson at the Los Angeles Rams. And he said, John Robinson told me that they are a great match for each other because John is the big picture guy, Bruce is the detail guy, and he is the offensive coordinator, and I think he's going to do a great job.
Dorsey moving forward to the 28-yard line. Kevin Burnett making the stop. It'll be third down and about 2 to go. And back to your point about Bruce Snyder, Bob, how often do you get 2 National Coach of the Years, former National Coach of the Years, on the same coaching staff?
Great point, Mark. And last year, Bruce actually called the plays in the last 2 games. He was a tight end fullback coach. They didn't announce it, but they did have improved productivity at the end of last season.
Yeah, hoping to spice up an offense that threw for only 7 passing touchdowns last year.
Critical third down right here, Mark, for UNLV.
Mankis completes it, and they convert it. That's Irvin Johnson at the 33-yard line with 4:33 to go. In the first half of play, Johnson last year was 60 catches for 834 yards and 4 touchdowns. Had 2 spectacular grabs against Wisconsin that I remember particularly from last year.
Highly recruited out of high school, Mark. Really was going to go to Georgia Tech. In fact, committed to Georgia Tech, but reminds John Robinson of Keyshawn Johnson a little bit with his ball skills and leaping ability.
Run the counter to Dorsey. Dorsey steps out of bounds at the 40. For more on Irvin Johnson, let's go to Holly.
Well, guys, as you might have guessed by his name, Irvin Johnson is indeed named after Magic Johnson. Now, he loves basketball, and John Robinson says that's something he likes about this player. He'll actually go up and rebound the ball, go up in a crowd and pull it down. But he is sad to admit that Irvin Johnson is not the best basketball player on the team. Hands down, they say it's Jamal Brimmer, and Irvin says even he has to agree. Mark?
All right, yeah. As a hoop guy myself, I got much love for Brimmer, although in this game has not provided the type of leadership maybe that John Robinson would want.
And Mark, if we talk about this football game, UNLV has had, in my opinion, some uncharacteristic mistakes out of veteran football players, particularly on defense, and also Kurt Nankus, the quarterback, and the miscommunication on the interception with Irvin Johnson. So they really are having some self-induced mistakes right now as this football game.
And one of their offensive linemen's down on the field as we have a timeout. The injured player, Brandon Gray, will have more when we come back. Back in Neyland Stadium with 108,625 watching, the third most in stadium history. The injured player for UNLV is Brandon Gray. And let's take a look at exactly how that injury transpired.
And Brandon Gray, Mark, will be the left offensive guard right here. We see him firing out on the 3 technique.
Kind of bent back, that leg.
He looked like he got bent back, and it looked like it was on the initial contact, not so much when he fell, but when he absorbed that blow right there.
And this offensive line, Bob, needless to say, very key for the development of the offense. The development of the offensive line will determine just what the ceiling will be, the coaches say, for the offense on the whole this year.
And Mark, they came into this game with only 2 offensive starters back on the offensive line. The center, Johnson, number 76, and Critchfield, the guard. So they are young at that position as well as inexperienced.
UNLV with Tennessee this week, and then not an easy one next week either. Don't want to look ahead too far, but they do travel up to Madison to take on Wisconsin, a game that you'll see on ESPN at 11 o'clock local time, 12 Eastern, next Saturday.
And Mark, you talk about scheduling. Tennessee plays this game tonight, obviously Sunday night. They're open next week on the short week and has Florida, I believe, coming in here to Knoxville. UNLV, on the other hand, flies back across the country tonight after this game, gets back early tomorrow morning, turns around and comes and plays Wisconsin at 11 a.m. Central Time on Saturday. So obviously a lot different
situation for Tennessee in scheduling.
John Robinson, though, drawing on all his coaching years of experience to lead his team through another minefield of a season. And John Robinson has a lot of important supporters. One of them, Mel Wolzinger, one of the big supporters of the program, not feeling well of late, but wanted to send our well wishes out to him. 6-6 a season ago for UNLV, and hey, what about the Mountain West Conference having some success early here?
Impressive. Huh? Impressive, Mark.
Second and four. Dorsey got the first down into Tennessee territory before finally being brought down by Harrelson. But Dominic Dorsey shows that he can break some tackles.
And Mark, it is apparent that UNLV, if they play well, has some capable talent to stay and compete in this football game. Their problem, they've been very inconsistent on both sides of the ball as far as execution.
Dorsey will get a rest. And for him is Eric Jackson in the backfield on first down and 10. Hankins open, complete, and still up is number 17, Terry Furlow, deep in Tennessee territory at the 15-yard line. So UNLV bent and intent on getting some points on the board before the end of the break here. Furlow with a nice pickup.
Excellent design to this play, Mark. Play action pass. They send the tight end down through the seam right here. You're going to see him clearing out. Then Furlow in behind him, really kind of double-layered the strong safety right there, kind of a high-low situation. Excellent design to that play-action pass.
Bob, UNLV burning one of its timeouts. They have one remaining. And Holly is standing by with Brett Shaver's mother. Holly?
Well, I'm here with Chandra. And Chandra, how did you find out that he was going to start tonight?
He actually called, I guess, after his practice was over.
What was your reaction?
I was surprised and shocked, but then I kind of calmed down and realizing how hard he's worked and his ability, that he deserves it.
What were you feeling before the game tonight?
Nervous. Very nervous. Probably more nervous than he is.
Did you give him any advice?
No, just play his game.
What have you thought of his performance so far?
He's done a really good job to be only 18 years old and to have such pressure on his back.
Tell us about your family back in Florida. Do you know if they've been able to watch any of the game at all?
I know the power is out where we're from, and my father turned on the generator so he could get the TV going, but I don't know whether they did or not.
All right, well, hopefully they're seeing this interview. If not, you tell them you were on ESPN, okay?
I hope so, too.
And congratulations, your son's done a great job.
Thank you very much.
All
right, Holly, they're better than me. I don't have a generator. I live down in Miami. We've got a little flooding down there, but hope they can watch the game and hope everything goes well down there.
Well, Mark, you see in Brent's mom interviewed right there by Holly, there are going to be so many highs and lows throughout this young man's career. And it really is complicated, let's be honest, with Eric Ainge being a true freshman as well. Both those guys on the same clock. So there's a bunch of things going to happen over the next 4 or 5 years.
They run the reverse to Donnell Wheaton, and he's brought down behind the line of scrimmage back at the 16-yard line. Mitchell making the stop for Tennessee.
Mark, getting back to my point about those two quarterbacks from UT. What do you think the odds are? And I know this is their first game in this stadium as true freshmen, but that they both finish 4 years here at Tennessee. That's a tough, tough situation. We have two young, talented guys.
I would say 60-40 against, but stranger things have happened. Second and 11. Those things have a way of working themselves out. Antis. Johnson made an adjustment on the ball, but couldn't come up with the grab. He was working against Jason Allen. Here at Neyland Stadium, Tennessee, number 15 in the country, leading UNLV 21-3 with 2:46 to go for the first time on a Sunday night under the lights at Neyland Stadium. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe. One of the big stories of tonight's game, number 7, Brent Shaver, has led his offensive unit to 2 touchdowns. Eric Ainge, starter number 1A, has led his offense to a touchdown as well. This is Dorsey trying to get to the corner. Nice move by Dominic Dorsey. Might have been a fumble. Kevin Burnett pouncing on the loose ball, and it's Tennessee ball. Kevin Burnett atoning for that personal foul celebration penalty.
Mark, first of all, it's third and 10. Excellent play call right here. Watch him break the safety down right here in the open field, Corey Campbell. And once again, your veteran football players, as we look at Brent Schaefer reacting, not playing as well as they're capable for UNLV.
Brandon Johnson made the hit, and as I mentioned, Burnett atoning for that penalty earlier. First down and 10. Ainge directing the offense now. Out to the five. Breach, what's coming up at halftime?
Well, Mark, coming up on the Olive Garden halftime report, Trev and Mark are here. Everything going right for this team in orange. That wasn't the case earlier. We'll take a peek to the week ahead and also talk about the end of a remarkable streak.
And Mark will revel in some of his upset picks from this weekend.
Why not? I was correct.
There is no apology for being right. Correct, Mayday?
Correct.
Hey, Mark May can celebrate about his upset picks if he wants to. I got no problem with it. Second down and 10. That's running out of the eye, and stopped up is Gerald Riggs Jr. by number 27, Jamal Brimmer.
Jamal Brimmer again, Mark, on the strong safety blitz from the field. Comes underneath. The question would have been if Eric Ainge would have kept that football again, there would have been no contain outside. But this guy is definitely a playmaker and a hitter. His problem tonight, not making the sure tackle. And that's hurt this football team.
Jamal Brimmer, good friends with Kevin Simon. The two of them, along with Miklos, Joe Miklos of the UNLV defense, hung out this past summer in New Orleans. Went there in June, and the three of them talked about this upcoming game. And Miklos and Brimmer made sure to let their friend Simon know that, hey, you guys better be ready. We're coming to play. Timeout. Tennessee on the field. Their last one. Take one more look at what Brent Schaefer has done today. Young man whose final decision between schools came down to Auburn, Miss, North Carolina State, and Tennessee. He started off a little bit rough. Fumbled it, but man, made a great move on the ensuing drive to cap the touchdown drive. Pretty effective on this quarterback draw. Bob, your thoughts on it?
Well, I think it's gone according to script for both young quarterbacks. I think they really have functioned well. I think the coaching staff has done well. But it shows you if you can line up and run the football with a power running game against this 3-4 blitzing UNLV defense, you have a chance to settle them down and be ahead of the chains. The real test is going to come, Mark, when it's off script and when negative things happen. But so far, as we look at Eric Ainge's 2 of 5 passing for 51 yards and one touchdown, things pretty much going according to script. And once again, it's remarkable. It's two true freshmen starting their first college football game.
Eric Ainge's father played basketball on scholarship at BYU. His grandfather, Danny's dad, and his father's dad, of course, was a three-sport star at the University of Oregon.
You have to wonder if we'll see the quarterback draw out of Eric Ainge here and see if this big 6'6 guy can run.
Out of the shotgun, put a receiver screen, but good defense by UNLV. Tinsley made the catch. For no gain on the play, Rashad Dodd-Masters and Terrence Young in on the stop for UNLV. With 1:05 to go, the Rebels call a timeout. They hope to get the ball back and perhaps get into field goal range and do something to get some more points on the board. They led 3-0, and then the Vols storming back with 21 consecutive points.
And Mark, they've had opportunities. They had the holding penalty that made them try the longer field goal attempt that they missed. They fumbled the football in the red zone just a moment ago. Dominic Dorsey, that's potentially 10 points right there. So they're still doing some good things and capable of coming back in this game.
It'll take a little bit of confidence if nothing less than to the locker room Thursday night at 9 Eastern. ABC's Monday Night Football officially opens its season when the Super Bowl champs New England hosts the Indianapolis Colts. It's the kickoff to Monday Night Football's 35th year, and it all starts this Thursday on ABC Sports Championship Television. Eric Ainge, number 10, there on the sidelines, and just running that last set of downs.
And we get a chance to see this punter again, Colquitt, left-footed, and he knocks it above the lights in the stadium, Mark. He is impressive.
Averaged over 45 yards per punt last season. A Ray Guy Award finalist. It's only his second punt tonight. His first one went 50 yards. But his heel is almost on the back line of the end zone. Another blast, which is fumbled. Wheaton. And another fumble. Still loose. Rebels got it back at the 19-yard line. Joe Miklos, the free safety. The Rebels looking a little bit disconcerted and disjointed and ragged right now. A 65-yard punt by Dustin Colquitt. One thing Philip Fulmer doesn't have to worry about is his kicking game.
Wow.
With Colquitt and Wilhoit.
Position, Mark. Field.
Unbelievable. Anything in the air that long on that punt should have a movie on it. Maybe two.
That was an illegal block in the back during the return by the receiving team. Penalty's half the distance to go, followed by a first down.
Colquitt, a consensus All-American a season ago. Take one more look.
And first we're going to see the block in the back right there. Excellent call. Then we're going to see the football come out right here. UNLV very fortunate right here. Number 45, Joe Miklos, the safety, comes up with the recovery, Mark. But talk about field position. A moment ago, you were talking about Colquitt's left foot on that far end line of this stadium. Look where this football is now.
On the 9-yard line. For more on Colquitt, let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, as you mentioned, it is a family legacy. His father is third on the all-time punting list. He's second, and his cousin Jimmy is first. But the real problem that Dustin has to work on is punting too much. He has got to limit himself to 70 to 60 punts a day. Sometimes it creeps up to 100. But Coach Phil Fulmer says we want him to continue to limit those because we don't want him to outdo his leg. I don't think that's a problem, guys, because so far that leg looks live and powerful despite the many punts a day. Mark?
Sure does, Holly. Like on that last play, back the ball up to the 4-yard line. Both teams out of timeouts here.
Mark, obviously for UNLV to come in here and have a chance to win this football game, and John Robinson said it, they were capable of playing with and maybe beating Tennessee if they played their best. But obviously, no one would say that UNLV has played their best performance here in this first half.
And Enquez takes a knee, and that'll be the last play of the first half. A first half in which UNLV came out, was very opportunistic, scored first, led 3-0, and then Tennessee came back with 21 straight, and Holly Rowe is standing by with Philip Fulmer.
Coach, what did you learn about Brent Schaefer tonight?
Well, about what we saw in practice, he's a pretty special player, and really happy about Eric as well, so they're young. They're going to make some mistakes. UNLV's given us a lot of things, you know, trying to confuse them, and they've handled it reasonably well so far.
How will you continue to rotate the two in the second half?
About the same. Both of them give us something different, and it's pretty exciting to watch them. You know, we're running the ball and helping them a lot. That's the main thing.
All right. Thanks very much, Coach. Mark, back to you.
All right, Holly, that's the end of the first half. The score, 21-3. Volunteers to kick. Wilhoit knocks it about 7 yards deep. And Dorsey will start off. on their own 20-yard line. Mark Jones along with Bob Davey, Holly Rowe down in the field. Bob, your impressions and thoughts so far on the quarterbacks for Tennessee.
Hey Mark, if I had to say one word to describe it, I would say efficient. Under some difficult circumstances, I think they've managed the game extremely well. They've done a lot of checking at the line of scrimmage, which is going to help them. I think they've handled that well. Bottom line, when you're able to line up and run the football, that helps everyone. So grade A to those running backs and offensive linemen that's really helping these young quarterbacks settle in and get some confidence right now.
See if Dorsey and the UNLV offense can get on track a little bit. It became disjointed towards the end of the second quarter. Let's take a look at the Rust-Oleum Epoxy Shield first half statistics.
Mark, what jumps out at you is really the total yards, 250 to 176, but the rushing yards of Tennessee, which leads to time of possession, which Tennessee controlled. UNLV did move the ball, particularly on misdirection runs with Dorsey. They just have to be...
And speaking of misdirection, that time Dorsey brought down by Kevin Simon. Let's go downstairs to Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, I checked in with John Robinson at halftime, and he said there's not a lot of panic in this team right now. They recognize they've been in the red zone three times and only come away with 3 points. Their focus here is to stop hurting themselves with mistakes. The 2 turnovers and then the 6 penalties for 54 yards were the critical problems in the first half. He says we clean those things up and continue to compete, we should be okay.
Third down and 15. Dorsey out of the backfield. Nice catch and a great move. Dominic Dorsey still on his feet. And a first down for the Rebels out near midfield at the 47-yard line. Boy, the little Dorsey is so dynamic out in the open field.
Mark, I'll tell you what, he is an exciting back. And I know right now in Madison, Wisconsin, Barry Alvarez is sitting there watching this game and saying, wow, that guy is dynamic. But just a little swing pass right here, and he does it on his own. Excellent quickness down the sidelines right there, Mark. And you can see why this guy, all-time leading rusher in California high school football.
A 24-yard pickup. This is Deontay Perkins, and Perkins is out to the 46-yard line. Let's take one more look at Dorsey.
And something, Mark, UNLV had tremendous success with in the first half. Misdirection plays, taking advantage of UT's speed on defense. Here you see both linebackers overshifted, and Dorsey comes back to backside. So misdirection running game by UNLV. Those really quick Tennessee linebackers, they've taken advantage of some of that. But wow.
At that time, Perkins got rocked back at the 44-yard line. Deontay Perkins, who had a team-high 9 touchdowns in 2003. Nowhere close that time.
And Mark, sometimes when you have two young quarterbacks like Tennessee does, it takes the attention away from the youth on their overall football team. We mentioned this defense, only 2 seniors in the top 31 on this Tennessee defense. That's incredible. But they are really explosive looking and explosive playing football team, particularly that front.
Third down and 5. Mantis threw it away.
Obviously, Mark, he's not outside the tackle box. Yep.
Yeah, we got a flag on that one. Didn't see it actually thrown, but that had to be.
Intentional grounding by offensive number 7. Foul is awarded to the next down. Fourth down, it's part of the foul. It'll be fourth down.
And this young secondary for Tennessee right here responds well. Really nowhere to go with that football. Irvin Johnson comes open late, but by that time, number 7, Nankus, is on his back right here.
Gary Cook ready to punt now. Second team All Mountain West Conference a season ago, averaged a little over 43 yards per. His first one went 54 yards. See what he does here. Into a bit of a wind, a low line drive kick. Out of bounds near the 20-yard line. Well, we talked about the true freshman quarterbacks, but it's not all about them. It's about the people around them. Here's Munoz.
We had the mindset from the very beginning that whoever's going to be back there, we were going to bring him along with us. And I think that hasn't changed, that, you know, whoever's going to be back there, we're going to help him out and, you know, pull this team along with us.
And this is earlier tonight, Munoz speaking with his quarterback, Eric Ainge. Always helps when you have that kind of senior leadership up front on the offensive line. Tennessee with three seniors, a junior and a sophomore, but Munoz easily one of the leaders of that group along with Jason Resper. First down and 10. Schaefer in at quarterback. Looking to go up top. And it's incomplete, intended for Chris Hannon.
Mark, let's go back to your point you made about Munoz and this supporting cast really embracing these young quarterbacks. You know, that's difficult because, let's be honest, for older players, guys that are in their fourth and fifth year, they really want the other guys that have made an investment, been through all those off-season programs, been through the hard times. And it's hard to embrace a young freshman quarterback. It really is. And as this season goes on, when the bumps in the road start to hit, we'll find out. And I really feel good about this football team because of the leadership we talked about.
Second down and 10. They've been going well right now. Nothing to argue about. Houston runs it down to the 24-yard line. Munoz, the son of Anthony Munoz, former great in the NFL, Pro Bowl player, Cincinnati Bengals from 1980 to 92, inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1998, made the Pro Bowl 11 consecutive years, and also played at USC under current UNLV head coach John Robinson. Actually, Munoz, the younger one, remembers meeting Robinson when he was in the eighth grade.
And Mark Cedric Houston down on the field right here.
Houston, a young man that last year played with a very heavy heart. Last year, his father as well as his grandmother passing away. Dedicated the season to his dad and really put up some good numbers.
And you saw the concern on Philip Fulmer's face over there, Mark. You know, one thing in coaching, we talked about with guys that have made an investment. And you know what, as a coach, that's what you really appreciate, those guys. I mean, no one on the outside realizes what all these kids go through just to come in this stadium and play these 11 games all year. So his concern is for the welfare of that football player right now.
Well, we have Holly Rowe down at the field, and we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll have some information on the other side. Welcome back to Neyland Stadium, and a pall of silence falling over the 108,000 plus as Cedric Houston was injured on the last play. The senior letterman still down on the field. Let's take a look one more time at what exactly happened. Coach Fulmer out in the field.
Mark, it's really hard to see what happens. Right here, he takes an excellent shot. Right here. And then, you know, he's bent backwards.
Coaches this year have been very proud of Cedric's leadership and the way he practices hard every day. He brings a lot of experience and toughness to the backfield. Those are the words of his coaches. And he has been pretty prolific tonight, almost 100 yards rushing. His backup is Gerald Riggs. And there comes Riggs now into the ball game for Tennessee. Gerald Riggs Jr.
And if you noticed, Mark, Gerald Riggs immediately came off that bench and went out there and checked on the welfare and the injury of Cedric Houston.
Third down and 7. Eric Schaefer, check that Brent Schaefer out of the back, out of the shotgun.
We're going to get weak safety blitz right here by Jamal Brimmer.
And Schaefer brought down at the 24-yard line by Jamal Brimmer. It'll be fourth down for Tennessee. That time, Tennessee seemed to be a little confused offensively.
Well, you can see Jamal Bremer, Mark, coming underneath right here, redirecting his steps, and gets the talented young quarterback on the ground. I mean, bottom line, Jamal Bremer has made some mistakes tonight, but he is an active football player. He's fun to watch. And now it's Colquitt time again. This place will erupt.
Another punt. Boy, he has had a couple of big ones tonight of 50 and 61 yards. Standing on his own 10.
And punting with the wind a little bit, Mark.
It came after him.
Didn't quite get that one.
Oh, and what a hit on the catch by Donnell Wheaton. Great special teams coverage as Jonathan Hefty came down and made a big lick on the play. A 42-yard punt and nothing on the return. They came after the kicker, Colquitt, a little bit.
And Mark, one thing, even though he didn't hit it exactly square, he had enough hang time that allowed excellent coverage, and man, that is a shot right there.
Look at Hefty just come in like a missile. Nose of the ball on the 33-yard line. Time for UNLV to get with the program. Mankus backside pressure sacked at the 25. Jason Hall, number 94, the 6'3 junior, with the sack.
I'll tell you, we talked about Tennessee's front being explosive. Watch the left end right here, number 90, Turk McBride, just flushes the thing out. And then from the backside, Hall, 94, gets the sack. Young, explosive front, Mark. I like this front seven from Tennessee. They're athletic.
Front seven is going to have to make a big contribution in the SEC East this year. Dorsey back in the ball game, stopped up by Kevin Burnett. Burnett, the leader of the defense a season ago for Tennessee, an all-SEC player, an academic all-conference player as well, grad student right now.
Mark, I thought we'd see a little more quick three-step, get the ball to receiver, running backs in the open field kind of attack from UNLV. It's apparent they cannot protect with only two starters back on that offensive line. Here they don't have much of a choice but to maybe throw a screen ball or throw the ball down the field.
Third and 14. Nankus threw it back across his body, incomplete. Good pressure up front by Kevin Simon, who is coming on a blitz. Three and out for the Rebel offense. And offensive coordinator Bruce Snyder trying to figure out what his next move is going to be.
And give credit to John Chavis, the defensive coordinator here at Tennessee, Mark. He's been here a long time. He's seen a lot of good defenses. They've always been a pressure man-to-man team. Aggressive linebackers, aggressive play.
Gary Cook to punt, standing in his own 13-yard line. Tinsley lets it bounce at the 30. They're going to get a good little roll out of it down to the 18-yard line. Holly Rowe, what's coming up?
Well, Mark, when we come back from break, I'm going to speak with Anthony Munoz. He is here watching his son play against his former coach, John Robinson. All that coming up after the break.
At the ball game, the former NFL All-Pro selection. First down and 10 for the Volunteers. Schaefer in a quarterback on the wagon. The pass complete to the fullback, Corey Anderson. Let's go downstairs to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, I am here with Anthony Munoz. And tell us a little bit about what it's like to watch your son play against your former coach, John Robinson, from USC.
It's really strange. You know, it's been, 24, 25 years that I played for John at USC. And to see him still roaming the sidelines, it doesn't surprise me that he's still there because he's such a great coach. But now my son, who's in his senior year and he's playing against John, it's a lot of fun.
What did you learn from Coach Robinson that maybe you passed on to your son?
Well, I think the main thing is he cared about you not only as a football player but as a person. I think those are some of the things you carry with you after you finish the game, and even while you're playing, you get to pass that on to your son. And one of the things we learned at USC was to, you know, we always stress to try to dominate people, and Michael's kind of, you know, on his own gotten that characteristic. And so I can just kind of emphasize through the things I learned with Hudson Hauk, his offensive line coach, and John Robinson as the head coach.
Your son made a great comment, I thought. He said, we know there are these young quarterbacks. That means we're all going to have to be better. How would you assess that they're helping those young quarterbacks tonight?
I think they've been playing tremendously. Of course, not only the offensive line, but you look at the wide receivers, and then Cedric Houston, the running back, and Gerald Riggs. And I think that's the one thing that's really helped out these young quarterbacks is they have some veterans around him that are really going to help out, you know, both of these young quarterbacks.
Okay, so be honest. What's a typical phone call or conversation like between you and your son after the game? Critique or love?
Well, first it's love, and then he'll ask questions, and then I'll kind of give just a couple critiques. But
Like what?
Well, a lot of it is, you know, go back and forth between the mental and the technical. And it's just little things having to do with balance and hands and, you know, keep your head out and those type of things that really allow you to make the blocks. But it's not a whole lot of those things. And most of it is, you know, how do you feel afterwards and how do you feel that you did? And then we'll move into the other.
Do you grade the film?
I do not. I think I've watched a couple games that he has sent to me, but I'm not the kind of dad that goes in and watches every single play. I watch it every, you know, while I'm watching him live, so that's good enough for me. I don't have to go in and watch his tape.
All right, well, I think he doesn't need any help right now. He's doing okay tonight, so thanks very much. Mark, back to you.
All right, Holly, great to have a dad who's an all-pro, and good protection by Munoz on that completion to Tony Brown, Bob.
Well, excellent protection. Brent rolled opposite of Munoz right there, so it was really a pretty easy assignment. But that's a great family. His sister came to Tennessee, played basketball, has since, I believe, transferred to Ohio State. So the whole family is athletic, Mark.
First down and 10 after that gain of 24 yards. Munoz, the starting left tackle on the running play here. Son of another NFL great, Gerald Riggs Jr. And Jr. pushed out of bounds at the 31-yard line. We asked Michael Munoz if he felt any pressure growing up as Anthony's son.
I haven't, and I think a lot of it is to be credited to my parents, because the way that they raised me is that I need to realize that I'm Michael Munoz, not Anthony, and that you know, I can only be the best player that I can be.
You know, he's already in a master's program for public administration, so the young man is, Bob, taking care of business on the football field and in the classroom as well. That last play, a pickup of 20 yards by Gerald Riggs Jr. Schaefer going up top, has a man. Touchdown, headed. Great pass and catch to Mitchell. Robert Meacham got in behind Ernest Gordon.
Mark, these Tennessee fans have been waiting to see Robert Meacham, number 3, 6'3", 210 out of Tulsa. They say around here he will be the next great UT wide receiver. Really physical, only practiced 3 days last fall, so they never had a chance to see him play. They love this young receiver.
Extra point knocked through by James Wilhoyd and a flag down on the field. What about the soft touch and the timing by Brent Schaefer, the true freshman? Put a little bit of air under that ball, Bob, and got it to his receiver, Meacher.
Foul is offside. Number 14 red. That foul is declined. The 1 point is good.
Sometimes you can't get it done without the right type of protection. Meacham on the other end of that pass, but up front it was Michael Munoz. Call him Kevin Costner because he looked like the bodyguard for his quarterback that time. We'll be back with more as a proud papa watches on right after this. Three on the drive. Dorsey takes a knee, and they'll come out to the 20-yard line.
Mark, Tennessee, I think, has done a great job of keeping it simple for these quarterbacks. First, you see one safety in the middle of the field. Brent knows it's man-to-man on the outside. What I'm really impressed with, he checked to that play. The second thing, Mark, great soft touch that sometimes young guys struggle with. But I think Tennessee's done a good job of that three-wide formation, giving him a simple thing of reading whether it's one safety deep or two safeties deep. I'm a little bit surprised that UNLV is not disguising those coverages a little more and trying to confuse him. They're locking into the coverage, and Tennessee's taking advantage of it.
And right now, Eric Ainge, hoping that he'll be the next one to come in, get his turn.
And Mark, I think that's the point. You know, it's human nature. It's inherent that there's competition between those two. And that's a good thing right now on a night.
There was holding by number 42 on the receiving team. That penalty is declined. The automatic touchback. First 10 at the 20.
UNLV going to start off on its own 20-yard line. The first meeting between these two teams, Tennessee won it 62-3. First down and 10. Furlow in motion. Irvin Johnson with a reception for the first down at the 32-yard line. We're here at Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, Tennessee. Number 15, the Volunteers, leading the Rebels 28-3 with 8:02 to go in the third quarter. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe down to the field. Don't forget that SportsCenter is coming up next. Gang back in the studio with a recapping a busy day in sports, including some college football action. Oh boy, Dominic Dorsey stopped on a dime, didn't leave Tennessee any change, and what a move. Ran out of bounds at the 38.
Mark, Dominic Dorsey averaged 8.7 in the first half. A lot of it on this misdirection. When you have a real speed defense like Tennessee, you try to give them opposite direction, and wow. A missed tackle right there by Jason Allen.
He was tackling ghosts on that one.
I'll tell you what, he won't see many, if any, quicker backs than this guy.
A little bit of Fred Russell in his game. Dorsey, former Iowa back, and of similar stature and build, and maybe a little taller at 5'8", but not by much. Dorsey out close to the first down at the 40-yard line. Burnett making the stop for the Tennessee defense.
Mark, it doesn't get much easier for John Robinson. Next week, as we mentioned, they go to Wisconsin. Wisconsin's a powerful athletic front. John Robinson, UNLV rather, in 10 years, Mark.
And there's Deontay Perkins, broke a couple of tackles with a first down and more out to the 35, and a first down for UNLV.
John feels better right now, but getting back to the story I was trying to get in there, in 10 years before John Robinson arrived at UNL, excuse me, in 32 years, they were on television 10 times, Mark, in 32 years before John Robinson's arrival. They've been on 27 times in the 6 years he's been there. So a high-profile coach has done a lot of things for this UNLV program, really has put them on the map.
Good fit for him and UNLV, and nice to see Coach Robinson in good health. Had a heart attack not that long ago. First down and 10 after that 23-yard gain. Nat Case looking over the middle on the post. Irvin Johnson with the catch at the 16-yard line. And Nankas took a lick right after the pass.
Again, you see the capability of UNLV, and Nankas is going to take a big shot right here by Kevin Simon and also Justin Harrell coming late. But the crossing route by Irvin Johnson, the ball's actually thrown behind him a little bit, Mark. Obviously, if he'd have caught that in stride, he'd have a chance to score.
First and 10 for the Rebels. Wheaton in motion. Out of the backfield, it's complete to Marshall. And Marshall making it down to the 3-yard line. And another first down for UNLV.
Good job by UNLV of motioning and then crossing route by the wide receiver, really creating a pick situation. The fullback, Alvin Marshall, out in the flat off the play action. Mark, this guy originally signed with Nebraska out of high school. Ended up being a junior college recruit, one of the highest recruited guys ever at UNLV.
Perkins, the deep back, he gets the call. Perkins, touchdown, Rebels. Got a nice lead block by Henley.
Touchdown.
That was the most impressive sequence of the night offensively for UNLV.
No question about that, Mark. And regardless of what happens in this football game, it gives them a little momentum late in this game. And there's 10 other games after this. And they show again that they are capable offensively if they can execute.
The extra point is good by Aguayo. And it's 28-10 with 5:51 to go in the third quarter. When we come back, will it be Eric Ainge directing that offense? We'll find out in just a minute. Larkin's one of those three running backs, and of course, the starter tonight, Cedric Houston, was injured a few moments ago. Larkin's out to the 17-yard line in Holly. What's up with Cedric Houston? How is he?
Well, right now they're evaluating his lower leg and ankle. The good news is it is not as serious an injury as they originally thought. It's doubtful that he'll return, and they'll get us more information as soon as they have completed the evaluation. Mark?
All right, Holly. Cedric Houston making like Cedric the Entertainer tonight, because he certainly was entertaining with those runs. 12 of them for 97 total yards on the ground. And there's Gerald Riggs, number 31, his understudy, who right now is being elevated one notch higher, although Larkins stays in the ball game as the deep back, and Eric Ainge is the quarterback. Eric Ainge's turn. Fires a dart complete to Josh Swain. Jason Swain with the reception. Gets the first down for Tennessee.
Mark, we had a chance to see Eric Ainge before the game down there, really just in street clothes, and he is an impressive looking guy. Oh. He is all of 6'5" and more physical looking than I thought he would look for a young guy.
First down and 10. Deliberate and patient at the line of scrimmage. And it pays off more times than not. Out to the 43 on the reception, it's Jason Swain again. That's been their MO tonight. Come up to the line for the young quarterbacks, check with the sidelines, get the right play, and make it work, Bob.
And Mark, it really is pretty simple plan. And UNLV has helped them a little bit, once again, in my opinion. They're not really disguising in the secondary as much. They're jumping those linebackers up in there, but it's really pretty easy for these young quarterbacks just to look at that deep safety and determine the numbers.
Pickup of 13 on the last play, first down and 10 at the 42.
And right here, they see the strong safety blitz coming from the field. So he's going to have man-to-man coverage on the outside, Mark. They choose to run away from the strong safety.
Running into the boundary that time. That was Corey Larkins, brought down by Isaac Watson. Let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, keep in mind that Eric Ainge just graduated from high school in July, got to campus here, but he had been working on the offense for 4 to 5 months before that with Randy Sanders. Obviously, they had gotten him a playbook, but then Randy Sanders flew all the way out to Oregon several times to sit down with his young quarterback and help him work through the offense. So when he got to campus, he could hit the ground running. I asked Eric before the game if it helped. He said, absolutely, but the best way I'll learn the offense is tonight in live action.
Nothing like the real thing, Holly. And he looks like the real deal, completing the pass to Chris Hannon near another first down. Eric Ainge had an opportunity to speak with his uncle Danny, the general manager of the Boston Celtics and former player. And Danny told him, hey, just go out and have fun tonight. Pretend you're back home just playing in the backyard. He seems to be pretty relaxed.
Well, it's fun tonight. There's no question about that. And this Tennessee receiving crew is also very impressive, Mark. They went out 2 years ago and I think had an unbelievable recruiting class with wide receivers. And there's your guy, Danny Ainge.
You know, I had this guy on my summer league team when I was growing up in Toronto. And you know what happened? He was playing baseball with the Blue Jays. The Blue Jays found out about it and put an axe on that. He said, you can't play basketball while you're on our baseball team. I guess they're afraid of him getting hurt.
Well, if you tell that whole story like you told me, you brought him in as a ringer. You didn't tell anybody else in the league who he was, and because you were up in Canada, no one really recognized or knew
him. At the time, he was an unknown, and they all kept saying, Jonesy, who's that guy who's busting everybody's you-know-what? And, boy, the secret was out of the bag after a while. First down and 10. His young nephew getting it done. Eric Ainge hands it off to his tailback down to the 45-yard line. That's Corey Larkins, brought down by Adam Seward. You know, Corey Larkins, one of a group of those tailbacks. He is, I'm told, the prankster of the group.
And also, Mark, I heard he's the toughest player on this team, pound for pound. And he started at the bottom of the list as well. He's had some different things happen to him throughout his career. Again, the new running back coach comes in. Everybody has a clean slate. He's taking advantage of that.
Jabari Davis in for him now.
Again, Mark, pretty simple. We see the strong safety blitz from the field. He knows it's one-on-one on the outside. Do they throw it or do they run away from it?
Ainge passes it, and it's complete to the near sideline. Nice catch that time by Chris Hannon. Let's go downstairs back to Holly.
Guys, one last thing that Eric Ainge has taken from his Uncle Danny. You will notice on his right wrist is an elastic band. I asked him before the game, hey, what's that? Is it to remember something? He said, no. When I was a kid, I used to watch my uncle play for the Phoenix Suns. He and Dan Marley would wear these on their wrists for good luck. I was so impressed with it as a young kid. I've worn it ever since, and he's got it for good luck tonight as well.
It worked for Danny in his basketball career. Worked for Dan Marley, too. First down and 10. Ainge has connected on his last five passes for a total of 42 yards. Going up top. No flag on the play, and it's incomplete. Chris Hannon wrestling downfield with Ernest Gordon. Boy, Tennessee's got some tall receivers.
Well, Mark, once again, the big tennis player, number 49, Ryan Clarich. Excellent pass rusher. You know, he's an inside linebacker in the regular defense, but they also play Clarich a lot as an outside linebacker rusher. And John Robinson really thinks he'll be an NFL player. He played tennis at UNLV, not just in high school. He's 6'4", 250 pounds.
Wasn't even aware they had a program out there.
Oh, yeah.
Second down and 10. Jabari Davis, the tailback. Good block. Davis with a great run down to the 22-yard line. Jabari Davis has a Tennessee first down. You know, when it comes to football, Bob, it really is a family situation. Ran into his mother in the hotel, and she was just pleading for him to have a good night tonight.
Well, once again, these running backs are strong. I mean, look at the lower body on him, and he just flat runs over Isaac Watts, number 90 right there. There's some power in that backfield.
Houston was shaken up moments ago. So it's been a diet of Riggs, Larkins, and Jabari Davis. Ainge looking at his offensive coordinator, Randy Sanders. Davis again. Flag down on the near side of the field at the 24-yard line. Chris Hannon may have moved a little bit early.
Mark, and that's one of the disadvantages of doing all the check with me stuff at the line of scrimmage. A lot of times you get formation violations and procedure penalties because guys can just not stay in those stances that long.
Interesting with the different cadences, two of the quarterbacks. You know, Bob, they actually have what they call choir practice between the quarterbacks with Schaefer and Ainge. The two of them will vocally call out all the plays, and they work on their voice inflection.
Mark, I think you bring up a great point. And give Philip Fulmer credit. It took a lot of courage. But by making that decision early instead of waiting, letting the two veteran quarterbacks on his team take the snaps through preseason and then making it late, by making it early, he's allowed his football team to work with that cadence with the young guys all through camp. So, yeah, I mean, Philip Fulmer made a tough decision. Give him a lot of credit for having the courage to make that decision.
1:45 to go in the third quarter. First and 15 after the penalty. Ainge completes the pass at the 22-yard line to Tony Brown. Gave him a little bit of yak some yards after contact and dragged Rashad Dodds-Masters for three more yards.
And Tony Brown, Mark, captain of this football team. He's steady. He plays all positions. Played for George Smith down at St. Thomas Aquinas High School in Fort Lauderdale. They've turned out a bunch of players. This is a quality young man that's had a great career. Gets overshadowed a little bit because they've got some really young, dynamic receivers that everybody's anxious to see.
Second down and seven. Brown a little nicked up after that gain of 8 yards. Second down and seven. Quick three-step drop. The slant complete. Down to the 6-yard line, Brett Smith with the catch. And it's first down and goal to go for the Volunteers.
Mark, once again, it's three deep coverage. It's really stealing right now, but another one of those young, talented Tennessee wide receivers, Brett Smith.
11th play of the drive coming up.
Mark, this is like in high school back in Oregon right now. And he's picking this thing apart.
On the fade. Incomplete, intended for Chris Hannon. You know, Tennessee's got some big receivers on the outside, Bob. They got Hannon at 6'4". Tony Brown at 6'3". Meacham at 6'3" as well.
Great point, Mark. Tall and fast. I mean, Chris Hannon, number 13, 6'4". They have him at 4'2'8", the fastest player on this football team. Meacham, 6'3", 210. He is big and physical, was a great high school basketball player. Then Brett Smith, number 9, the young guy, is a dynamic player. And Tony Brown's the old guy that's the steady player.
Second down and goal. Jabari Davis drives the left side, running over Munoz's back. Down to the 3-yard line. Brought down right there by Nicholson. Two seconds to go, and that'll be the last play of the third quarter on a very historic night. On the fade. Touchdown. He cashed the check. Tony Brown.
This is like a practice right now for Tennessee, schematically, and these freshman quarterbacks are carving this secondary of UNLV. It's man-to-man coverage. They're going to throw the corner out, and an excellent throw by young Eric Ainge.
The lead is now 35-10. You get a flag down on the far side of the field. Eric Ainge is 10 of 15 passing for a total of 118 yards. And a couple of touchdown passes as well.
Mark, once again, they had Jamal Brammer locked up right here, man-to-man on Tony Brown. Obviously, he's more of a hitter and a run-stopper blitzer than he is a coverage guy. But excellent touch, and what a confidence boost for two freshman quarterbacks, and Phil Fulmer has to feel really good right now.
That was the fifth career touchdown reception for Tony Brown, and this a historic night in Knoxville, Tennessee. Schaefer becoming the first freshman quarterback right out of high school to start his opening game in SEC history. And the first Sunday night game under the lights here at Neyland Stadium. The attendance, the third largest ever in school history. And what about Smokey? We got Smokey, number 9, making his debut tonight.
Smokey's undefeated.
It's good.
You know what, Mark? We're making history. We made history yesterday afternoon,
right,
in Madison with the first overturn call with replay. We're making history tonight, right, with the freshman quarterback's debut. And with Smokey, number 9, undefeated right now. So we got a pretty good run going.
Where do we go from here? That's the hard thing.
Well,
I mean, we get to see couple of talented freshman quarterback, true freshman tonight, which has, for me, been really impressive. We arrived in town. That's all we heard for the last 36 hours was Ainge and Schaefer, Schaefer and Ainge, the waiters, the waitresses, all asking us, firing questions at us about who do you think it should be, who do you think it's going to be. Somewhat reminiscent, Bob, of the quarterbacking situation that happened back when Peyton Manning first came here.
Mark, exactly. Good point. And I think what you really see is how change in youth energizes everyone. I mean, like you said, this whole town, this football team, everyone energized by just seeing different guys out there, and they've done a tremendous job.
Return out to the 17-yard line, and tomorrow night at 8 Eastern, ESPN celebrating 25 years of sports coverage with our Silver Anniversary Special. We'll look at the defining moments, early coverage of the NCAA basketball tournament, the World Series earthquake, the 87 America's Cup. This is SportsCenter ad campaign, acquisition of the NFL, and more. ESPN 25 Silver Anniversary Special on ESPN tomorrow night at 8 Eastern time. First down and 10 for the Rebels. They scored on their last possession. Handed off here. Dorsey breaks a tackle. And another one. Dorsey brought down finally at the 31-yard line, but there's a flag back at the 23. He just squirts out of those tacklers' arms, doesn't he?
And if you're John Robinson, keep this guy healthy. I mean, it's 35-10 in Knoxville. Keep this guy healthy now. He is dynamic.
And that one's going to come back. It's against UNLV. You mentioned keeping Dorsey healthy. Behind him, it's Jaja Riley, and we've seen Eric Jackson a little bit. We've seen a lot more of Perkins, also at running back.
And UNLV actually anxious to see some young running backs. Judge O'Reilly, a highly recruited athlete from California that actually transferred from Ohio State, number two. We've not seen him in the football game tonight, but another tailback that actually I thought we would see.
But number 76 on the offense, penalty is half the distance to go, followed by repeated the first down.
Penalty was against the center, Marcus Johnson. There's Judge O'Reilly, the Ohio State transfer. First down and 19. They move the ball back near the 10-yard line. And the crowd here beginning to pump up the volume. Almost intercepted and incomplete. Into and out of the arms of Jonathan Wade.
And Justin Harrell, number 92, another one of those explosive defensive linemen at 300 pounds. For Tennessee, Memphis has had a tough night, Mark. He came in here, he was 25 years old. He's leaving here 35 years old tonight.
Second and 19. Eric Jackson in the backfield. Memphis 11-19 passing the ball. Hands it off out over the 13-yard line. Stop made by Maialona on Eric Jackson.
And Maialona is an interesting guy. Top-rated junior college defensive lineman in the nation. Came to Tennessee, only played two games last year, broke his foot, but he was in spring ball. Another one of those guys from Hawaii. He is strong now.
Hey, Bob, anyone that hunts wild boar in the deep woods of Hawaii, he's on my team.
Yeah.
And that's what he does for fun. Right now, with his intention set on that quarterback. Third and 17, they're bringing the noise. UNLV calls a timeout.
UNLV.
The kneeling faithful getting a little bit rowdy and loud. Timeout on the field. 35-10 for the Vols when we come back. The offense to 35 points. Right now leading 35-10. Memphis back to pass for the Rebels. Back at the 7. He came out of the pack. Hey, it's still live. Marshall. It was a fumble. The ball came out.
Mark, Tennessee comes with the blitz. And right here, obviously, the football comes out. Kevin Barnett punched it out of there. Alvin Marshall picks the football up. And fortunately for UNLV, they get a chance to punt this football.
Fourth and 16.
You hear Rocky Top in the background?
48. I think we're up to 36 now. Jerry Cook. 2 yards deep. His fourth punt of the night. Into the wind, the line drive punt. Returnable, that's Larkins. Larkins housing it big time.
Looks like this one's going to come back.
That was an illegal block in the back during the returning team, during the return. Going to be 10 yards from the spot of the foul.
Still looking for one on the field.
First down.
Well, they're going to bring it back to the 31-yard line.
We're going to get a chance to see this after this first and 10 snap by Tennessee. We'll get a chance to see the call.
Change in the ball game. Hands it off to Riggs. And another flag down. Don't forget that both Sports Center coming up next right here on ESPN, and tune in to ESPN News for more on our game on the post game extra. Primetime, Dion's going to talk a little bit and about who he wants to be. And Tiger versus Vijay Singh, a Tiger on the cusp of maybe losing that world number one ranking, and Junior Griffey helping out a family in need. All that coming up on Sports Center. Ball in the 25. Age hands it off, and nothing happened that time as Larkins, who apparently had a punt return for a touchdown moments ago, got tackled that time. Let's take one more look at it.
Mark, we're going to look up here on the top of our screen. Right there is the block in the back, so an excellent call. Tell you what, these officials don't miss, man.
Second down and 17. Ainge, as he's done all night, like Schaefer, looks to get the call from the coordinator, Randy Sanders, on the check. Threw it behind his intended receiver that time. That was tipped, actually, by Jamal Brimmer, too. Intended for number 13, Chris Hannon.
And Adam Seward, number 55, the linebacker for UNLV, is in the game. This guy is a two-time All-Mountain West Conference first-team performer. He's had two foot surgeries, missed some time in the spring, missed some time in fall camp, but he's back. He's from Las Vegas, state heavyweight wrestling champion. He also, John Robinson, thinks is an NFL player. They're coming with the all-out blitz now, Mark. It's straight man-to-man coverage. Tennessee will keep seven guys in to protect.
They haven't been able
to get a call here and throw the football.
They haven't been able to heat up those freshman quarterbacks much tonight. That's the pass he threw for a touchdown earlier tonight, but not this time. The pass intended for Swain.
Mark, and again, they go after Rashard Dodd Masters.
But it'll be fourth down and seven now on the incompletion.
And one thing about this Tennessee crowd now, they come to these games, 107,000 people, and they stay at these games. And it really doesn't matter who they play. You know, the great fans come out and support their teams. This could be Slippery Rock in here tonight. And I don't mean to offend Slippery Rock, but they'd have 107,000 people in this stands tonight.
They come to see magic, and they've certainly seen some tonight. Will Hoyt has already made one from 44. And he pushes this one off to the right. No good. What appeared to be a touchdown on a punt return called back, and then now they are unable to put any points on the board on this drive. 11:25 to go in the fourth quarter, and we talked about those great running backs and the guy that's taking care of them, Trooper Taylor. Holly?
Well, guys, Trooper Taylor is new to this running back position, Coach. He just joined the team this year, but he is the 10th of 16 children, so he knows a little bit about family. He said that he is running his stable of running backs like a family. When he got here, the first thing he did was write their names on the blackboard. But he said, instead of Cedric Houston, I put up Cedric Taylor. Or instead of Gerald Gray, Gerald Taylor. I wanted them to know that we're a family of Taylors. They represent me, and they represent Tennessee.
And so far, those running backs representing themselves well so far. We have a flag on the play. Hefney defending against Irvin Johnson that time. And Taylor getting his message across to Hefney right now.
Right here, we're going to get a chance to see late after this play. Hefney really lost sight of the football, but he kind of bench pressed him, picked him up in the air, and just body slammed him.
He may have thought that the catch was...
Mark, he did. Yeah. I don't think that was the issue. I think it may have been...
Number 33 by the defense. Penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot, followed by an automatic first down.
Mark, that's a good call. That's an unfortunate call because Jonathan Hefney, in my opinion, did lose sight of where the football was.
That would be his only reason for acting out that way.
Exactly.
First down and 10.
I would hope.
Dorsey. Tackled at the 45-yard line. And for more on Trooper, let's go back down to Holly.
Well, guys, just to finish it up, Trooper Taylor has been so fun to watch. He brings so much energy to this young running back core. He has had several injuries this year because he celebrates too much with the players, whether it's in a scrimmage or in games like tonight. He's had two broken fingers. He's hurt his ankle. He's dislocated his shoulder. He has been all over the place. He said, I keep forgetting I'm old and I can't take the beating anymore. But you got to love the enthusiasm these young backs have from their coach.
Holly, good point. Hankins up top. And a flag down intended for Irvin Johnson. Jonathan Wade in on the coverage.
Mark, I think this is an excellent call right here. Jonathan Wade went up over top of the back.
Anka's dialing Irvin Johnson's number once again.
Foul is pass interference by the defense. Penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
First down at the 40-yard line of Tennessee.
Right there, Mark. 17 penalties in this football game. I guess characteristic of the first football game of the year.
Johnson split wide to the top of your screen, number four for UNLV. Sanchez completes it to Johnson, who's chopped down at the 34-yard line by Hefney once again. The two of those having a nice little game within the game.
I'll tell you what, Hefney's a physical football player. You think back, he had a big hit on special teams. And this young Tennessee secondary, Mark, really has played pretty well, I think, don't you?
Yeah.
Safety position was really the concern tonight. And really only one starter, Jason Allen, back in the secondary. And they've hung in there and done a good job.
Last year, the secondary was the strength of that defense. Tennessee coming on a blitz. Dorsey underneath. Dorsey is brought down at the 27-yard line by Hefney one more time.
And I'll tell you what, if you can get Dorsey on the ground in the open field, you can get most anybody in this country on the ground. So that's a good tackle right there.
Hefney, a 5'10 true freshman, on that Tennessee defense in the secondary. It'll be first down and 10.
And Tennessee, Mark, really excited about this true freshman class. Also, the sophomore class that's already here. They've had two classes back-to-back. And there you see the GA or equipment manager or someone holding up the personnel that UNLV has in the game to help Tennessee's defense.
That's Perkins on the run, crossing the 25. The two and the one, Bob?
Well, Mark, everybody has different verbiage or different terminology, but normally what that would mean is that they have two running backs and one tight end in the game. And what that does, that alerts and that helps Tennessee's defense on where to line up. So let's look right here. There's your two backs, and there's your one tight end in the game. So that's 21 personnel. We see the tight end shift and the running back shift out of the backfield.
Mantis, incomplete in between a couple of receivers, Marshall and Donnell Wheaton.
Mark, I'm a little surprised that we haven't seen number 15, Shane Steichen, tonight for UNLV. I mean, they talked about going into preseason camp that the job was completely open. In fact, Nankus missed spring, and I really thought that they may alternate these guys a little bit. So, you know, maybe we'll get a chance to see him.
Steichen, a 6'4 sophomore. Last season, became the first freshman to start at UNLV since 96. Right now, watch him. Just hands it off to Dorsey. Dorsey taking a little bit of a pounding, but makes it down to the 17-yard line, close to that first down. You know, I invoked the name of Fred Russell earlier, Bob. Great little back that played at Iowa last year, recently with the Miami Dolphins in the NFL. That seems to be a little bit of a trend right now in college football, that a small little scat back type.
No question, Mark. We've seen it with Anthony Davis, a guy that UNLV will see next week.
That game on ESPN at 12 noon Eastern time.
It's amazing seeing the contrast in the style of these running backs from UNLV compared to Tennessee, Mark.
He did get the first down. Mankes looking one way the entire time, and it's incomplete. Off the hands of Terry Furlow. He's second down and 10.
And Mankes, to me, Mark, has not settled down all night. And he's, you know, he started the first 10 games last year for UNLV. He got hurt. He really played through some injuries late in the season to come back. As we mentioned, he was a pro baseball player. He's married and has two children. He's a little bit rattled. He's been unsettled all night.
Former pitcher in the Oakland A's farm system. On the toss this time, Dorsey getting to the edge. Really getting to the edge. Touchdown! Got a nice block by Johnson, and UNLV puts six more on the board.
And Mark, again, the best running plays for UNLV, misdirection. That time they faked the ball to the fullback going one way, flipped it, and again trying to take advantage of Tennessee's quick reaction. A block downfield by number 85, Marquez Johnson. Number four, Urban Johnson.
You have to be impressed with what Dorsey has done tonight running the ball. He's running 18 times for a total of 121 yards. The extra point is good. It's a 35-17 ball game. Dorsey with his fifth game of running for more than 100 yards of his career. There's the little guy making a big play. We'll be back with more after this. This is a very historic night in Knoxville, Tennessee. The first Sunday night game. And hey, what about these retro uniforms that the Volunteers are wearing? We haven't had a chance to talk about them much. Meanwhile, it's about time that they bounce back. That in the minds of many Volunteer fans. This is what they've done since winning the national championship in 98.
Mark, I think what jumps out at you is the two Peach Bowl losses, two consecutive seasons. They went into the Peach Bowl a 10-2 team, sixth in the country. If they beat Clemson, they come out of there a top five team. But it kind of correlates with draft picks. I look back, 2000, they had 9 players drafted, 2 first-round picks. 2002, 10 players drafted, 3 first-round picks. 2003, 8 players. Last year, only 4 players drafted. Highest was a fifth-round pick. So They've got some young talent. Those numbers on draft picks won't go up significantly this year, but in the next several years they will.
Schaefer completes the pass meanwhile to Brad Cottom. Out of bounds for the first down. Fulmer has been almost a lifer at Tennessee as an assistant, now the head coach for 13 years. Here's what he had to say about the pressure of coaching at Tennessee.
We're about championships here, and that's what we said when we started, and we've won our share, but we're looking for another. We need to get back in that mix. We tied for the Eastern Division last year, and that's not really what you come to Tennessee to do.
That time it was Riggs over the 40-yard line.
And Mark, I think a little bit of it is, you know, the emergence of LSU so prominent in the Southeast Conference, and also Georgia. You know, there's not many people really talking about Tennessee like you might think, but anytime teams in your league are upstarts in some way, and LSU goes out last year and shares the national championship, that gets everybody edgy, particularly these fans. But there are tremendously high expectations here at Tennessee, and there should be. I mean, you look around this place, there's not many places like this across the country in college football.
Although Steve Spurrier is no longer in Florida, you know that they have that date circled in a couple of weeks as they take on the Gators right here in Knoxville. Although some fans of the Volunteers admit to me that it's not as much fun without Steve Spurrier, but they'll still take a win anyway.
That's what's fun.
Second down and seven. They move by Riggs. Gerald Riggs Jr., the son of Gerald Riggs, former NFLer with Atlanta and with Washington. Talked about him struggling a little bit last year in the pass protection schemes, but that is obviously improved and no longer suffering from injuries like he did the first 2 years at Tennessee. Healthy and had perhaps one of the best springs of all the players on the roster.
And runs a 10-600 meters, Mark.
That helps.
And, you know, another guy with a clean slate because of the new running back coach. He had some problems with immaturity, different little things, nothing major. But once again, he's got a breath fresh of life here with a new coach.
Schaefer hands it off. Riggs again, man, he's got a burst. Brought down by John Andrews.
And one thing Gerald Riggs has done, Mark, that I think is an excellent point, his teammates trust him now and are really pulling for him because, according to the coaches, he's really done all the little things right. And you can fool a lot of people, but you can't fool your teammates. And the fact that they respect him says a lot that he's really up his level.
Nothing like peer pressure to keep others in line. Riggs with a career high 61 yards rushing, adding to that total on this play. Picked up about six or seven more down to the 33-yard line. 5:45 to go, first down and 10 for Tennessee. For every story like Riggs that ascends the two deep, there are unfortunately stories that involve the other side of the equation. One of them might be C.J. Leak, a wonderful kid who has been in the program for many years at Tennessee at quarterback, but now looking for a position. Played a little safety in training camp, now at tight end, Bob.
Mark, a sixth-year player who came into fall practice really the starter. I mean, everybody said that. So a lot of different dynamics going on, and I saw C.J. Leak this morning. They moved him to safety in camp. Now he's a tight end. He just wants to play some football. So, you know, certainly as good as it is right now for Eric Ainge and this young man, Brent Snyder, the reality is there's something else going on over there on that sideline with C.J. Leak as well.
And here's Riggs at the handoff from Schaefer. And Riggs, boy, just finding every nook and cranny and space in that UNLV defensive front. Taking his time behind his blockers here.
Well, Mark, and now you think about the kind of human drama of UNLV. I mean, right now, they're getting pounded. They're going to climb on that airplane, fly all the way to Las Vegas, get in there tomorrow morning, and then turn around and come back and play just a physical football team in Wisconsin Saturday at 11 o'clock Central Time. So you can see why John Robinson had that concerned look on his face.
That's a game you'll see on ESPN next week. And this is Riggs, stopped up after a gain of about 2 yards. Schaefer going exclusively on the ground. And we have a timeout in the field. Gerald Riggs Jr., Eric Ainge, a couple of very familiar names in the bigger picture of the sporting world. And we're going to keep playing. 4:07 to go. Tennessee in command, 35-17.
Mark, I wonder if Smokey, the new mascot, has taken it to the house yet. You think? You think at 35-17, is Smokey still in Neyland Stadium? That's what we're going to get Holly on right now.
He's feeling some major love right now, just like this runner, Larkins. Larkins, touchdown, Tennessee.
We're going to get another one of your favorite calls, Mark. Excessive celebration, I'm afraid, in that end zone.
Ultimately, won't affect the outcome of this one.
There's Mark.
Smokey.
Smokey. Smokey's thinking about that next treat, man. He could care less.
He's a little more sedate than the previous version. Don't want to use it all up early in the season, I guess.
How about that shot?
Show your teeth.
Well, he'll be biting when Florida comes in here, baby. He knows the difference between UNLV and Florida now. Trust me.
3:47 to go. A touchdown run by Corey Larkins. The team prankster among the running backs, but he was no joke on that touchdown run. The senior taking it in. I guess you're not allowed to chest bump your teammates or give your fraternity sign. Those two things have both earned unsportsmanlike conduct penalties this evening.
Henderson holds, one white, two attempts.
I don't want to belabor that point, Bob.
No, let me bring up one point. You'd love to know, is unsportsmanlike conduct reviewable with instant replay?
Oh,
I don't think it is.
Don't even start that.
But that's what you want, right?
Don't even start
that. I'm going to put you in charge of that.
Oh, Smoke, put it to bed, baby. We'll be back. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe. And don't forget, SportsCenter is coming up next. Primetime. Deion Sanders is going to vibe with the gang. And Ken Griffey Jr. helping out a family in need among many stories and highlights. This is Eric Jackson on the return for the Rebels. And Jackson is brought down at the 26-yard line. Let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, Smokey made his debut tonight, and I have to tell you, the vibe is good. I've been grading the tape, and the only thing that's really startled him tonight is the fireworks they light off after the touchdown. That has really startled him. He didn't like that very much. But he's loved the little kids. We'll see if he'll take a Smokey snack. He does get these during the game to keep his energy up. But you know what? Doesn't need it. He's doing okay.
You could tell Holly.
How many have you given him, Holly? He looks like he's had about five or six.
Just a couple, but you know, we're just trying to keep his energy up. You know, the players drink the Gatorade, so we keep the Smokey snacks up, so it's all good.
I'll tell you what, if Smokey's vibe's good tonight, I hate to see when it gets bad, man.
I saw Reveille the other day. Reveille had a little more jump in his step.
No, not after that Utah game.
Steichen in at quarterback for UNLV, number 15, the 6'4 sophomore we were talking about a few moments ago. Jaja Riley on the carry. But these are good times at the University of Tennessee. Of course, amongst the many accomplishments from Tennessee grads, Justin Gatlin. Shout out to him, the fastest man on the planet right now, the winner of the 100 meters in the recent Olympic Games, running a blistering 9.85. Former track star here at Tennessee. Run up the middle that time. Speaking of Justin Gatlin, there he is, edging out Francis Obiquelu and his teammate Sean Crawford to take the gold medal in one of the fastest 100 meters ever in the history of the Olympic Games. Gatlin really a star on the rise. He won six different NCAA championships while at Tennessee, left to turn pro, Bob, after his sophomore season. Versatility, runs anywhere between 400 and 100 meters. A great talent. Third down and one. This is Dorsey. Check that Riley. Riley gained about 8 yards.
We're going to get a chance to see Tennessee's upcoming schedule and a great job of scheduling, playing here on Sunday night, having an open date, and then they get the Gators right here in this stadium.
That big one, they got Georgia on the road this year, which is going to be a real pivotal game for both teams. Georgia got Tennessee here at home a season ago. And then this is how the Volunteers finish up.
Mark, it was interesting. We got into the hotel late last night, and all those Tennessee players, they stayed at the same hotel, all watching that LSU-Oregon State game on television. They were all up in the meeting room there, and you know, I got to say, they were rooting for Oregon State now to beat the Tigers.
Steichen back to pass. Underneath and incomplete. Intended for the fullback, Chad Henley. Don't forget that coming up right after the game, Sports Center. We'll go back to the studio as Deion Sanders primetime in our conversation, along with many interesting news highlights and scores from the day. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe. Tennessee leading UNLV 42-17 with 1:31 to go in the ballgame. Don't forget that for more on this game, you can catch us on the ESPN News postgame extra. Interviews and highlights. Wayne Perkins on the carry that time.
And Mark, if you're Tennessee, there may be a little concern coming out of this game. Obviously, you're going to take the tape and find a lot of things you need to improve on. But, you know, their run defense, UNLV has run the football a little bit. A lot of it misdirection with quick little Dominic Dorsey. But I think, you know, rush defense is a bit of a concern, if any concerns coming out of this first game, really.
You still have that coach's hat on, don't you? You got to find a little bit of something. But those two true freshmen have really done well tonight. Schaefer had a few more plays than Ainge.
And it'll be interesting to watch that thing unwind, Mark. Not only over the course of this season, but in three or four seasons with the two freshmen.
In a different kind of sense, they weren't both freshmen. I don't think they were anyway, but it was the whole Applewhite-Chris Sims thing. Remember that playing out in
exactly.
a real controversial
exactly.
way at Texas a few years back.
Exactly.
And then here I mentioned when Peyton Manning first came through, he and Brandon Stewart engaged in a competitive battle at quarterback.
Mark, you said it earlier. Those things have a way of working themselves out.
Yes, and don't forget, SportsCenter is next. Fourth down and 10. Cook with a high short punt that bounces at the 22. Wasn't that long ago, like I said, that these guys were just figuring out how to shave and worrying about what to wear at the senior prom. Schaefer and Ainge showing their various skills running and passing. This was a nice check to a touchdown pass for Eric Ainge, who didn't start the game but came in on the game's third offensive series for Tennessee. Schaefer, 7-10 passing for 123 yards.
Tennessee, Mark, with 511 yards total offense.
And look who's in at quarterback, C.J. Leak. Check that, it would be Rick Clausen in at quarterback. Rick Clausen, the brother of Casey Clausen, now getting a shot with the Tennessee Titans. Recently signed with them. And Leak got into the ball game.
How about that?
This one's done. The final score, Tennessee 42, UNLV 17. As youth was served tonight at the quarterbacking position for Tennessee. Don't forget, SportsCenter is coming up next. And tune into ESPN News for our post-game extra. For Bob and Holly, I'm Mark Jones. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.